Okay. All right, I think we will be just about to start. For some reason, waiting for a couple other people. But okay. Do you think I should wait like 5 more minutes for people, or do you guys think I should start? All right. Looks like people want me to begin, so just a second. I'm gonna be just about to start, everyone. So I'll wait till Sean comes back in, and then if it's still not working for Sean, then I'll just go forward, and whoever is able to participate will, and then the others who can't. This will be recorded. I'm recording it, so for those who are unable to make it, you will be able to listen to it. All right, so looks like we're good then. So I'm gonna begin. I've done some presentations before on the temple scroll, and I tried to show evidence that the temple scroll is in fact the original version of the Book of Deuteronomy, and I showed what I believe is some compelling evidence, and I went in great detail in regards to the general overview of evidence I found to support that proposition. All right, Sean, can you say the picture is frozen, but can you at least hear me? If you can hear me, then if the image is frozen, it's not a big deal. As long as you can hear the audio, that is good. So, basically, I'll just tell you though of the evidence that I found that the Temple Scroll is in fact the original version. What I found is certain documents which are quoting from the Law of Moses, saying the such and such was written in the Law of Moses, but the only problem is it's not written in our copies what these other writings are saying. So, for as an example, in the book of Nehemiah, Nehemiah says things are written in the Law of Moses, but they're nowhere to be found in our copies. However, they're found in the Temple Scroll. And so we have different things like that, where other books, especially in the Old Testament, but also other extra books like apocrypha books, are quoting laws which are nowhere found, but are attributing it to Moses and saying this is in Deuteronomy and it's not found in Deuteronomy. So we have that. And then we also have certain writers are quoting from the Law of Moses as Yahweh. Barbara, can you hear me? Can you hear the audio of me speaking? Because if you can, then it's okay. So basically, there are writers that quote from the Law of Moses, but they quote it as Yahweh, God, speaking to us in the first person, like God is addressing us, or addressing Moses actually, and saying, I, me, my, in those very same passages. that correspond with Deuteronomy, we see it, he never says I, me, or my, but it always has, it makes it look like Moses is addressing, referring to God in the third person, like, the Lord your God, or, you know, Yahweh your God said this. And, but, as I said, other writers, like the Book of Nehemiah, First Baruch, that's an apocryphal book, those books are quoting from the Law of Moses as Yahweh speaking to Moses in the first person. And this does not occur in any of our copies of the Torah, but it occurs in the Temple Scroll. So what that tells me is that these ancient writings, these are very ancient writings, these ancient writings had a version of the Torah that closely, that has a lot of features which are very similar to what we're seeing in the Temple Scroll. And what I've also found was that the arrangement, the order of the Temple Scroll, of the Book of Deuteronomy as we have it in our copies, is very inferior and is not really indicative of divine inspiration. It's kind of randomly put together. It really looks like someone chopped something up and tried to put it back together, but it was a mess and chaotic. So, is Deuteronomy really divinely inspired? Because how can it be when it's all like, when you can see human touch on it? It is very inferior, and there's errors and flaws that just, and it's not, there's a lot of ambiguities. It's not very clear on some of the laws. And so I've just seen a lot of things from my study of all this that make me highly convinced that the Temple Scroll is, in fact, the original version of the Book of Deuteronomy. And if that is true, that is highly significant, because most Jews and Christians, you know, will appeal to the Law of Moses as we have it as, like, the main extent of the laws that God gave to his people. The Jews like to say that there are 613 commandments of the Law of Moses. They put a lot of emphasis on that number. But really, the 613 number is gibberish. It's garbage. There's no validity to that. That's just how many commandments are in their version. But if the original version was much longer, as the Dead Sea Scrolls suggest to us, all the Dead Sea Scroll copies have a much longer Torah. So if the original Torah was much longer, then that would indicate that there's many more commandments than just the 613. And if there's more commandments, then maybe people who claim to be righteous, law-abiding Jews are not. Maybe there are other commandments that people are disobeying. And if we're not obeying these commandments, then when on Judgment Day, when God will judge people, he will look and see, how did you judge others? And when you look down on other people for breaking the laws, when you yourself are breaking the same laws in other ways that you don't know about, you know, you're guilty for the same thing. So I think there's going to be a lot of people surprised on Judgment Day, realizing there was much more that he was requiring in his writings. And so if you want to be a true Christian and a true Jew, you know, faithful to the original, then you need to first figure out what did the original say, and then try to follow that to the best of your abilities. If you're not willing to do that, then you can't really, then you're just pretending and faking yourself into being a good and faithful servant when you're really not. And for people who do not accept the authority of the scriptures, of the Bible, it is still a very highly significant thing, this proposition I bring forth of the temple scroll being the original, because if it is, that changes a lot of history. That throws a wrench into things, and it's really significant for all fields of study, this idea. And so it's definitely worth considering. Now, one second. Okay. So, yeah, so that's just the basic overview of the concept and the importance of the temple scroll being the original version. And basically, it's called, we know of the book as Deuteronomy. Now, why is it called Deuteronomy? That was a name that was found on the Dead Sea Scrolls. It means second law or secondary law, but it also has a meaning of reiteration. It's repeating the law, and also re-presenting it, or a representation. The word representation, it refers to having the overall picture of it. It's a representation of something. But it's also a re-presentation. It's presenting it again. And it's presenting the entire law of Moses, again, afresh for us, and going into greater detail to help us understand certain things that weren't made clear in the other books. And basically what we see, if the temple scroll is in fact the original version, is that Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, those were the laws given, and they were expressly intended and given for a context of when the temple is not there. That was the context that was given. And in a context of being in the desert, wandering, you don't have a nation, you know. So these are laws, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, outside of Israel, and outside of the holy place that was to be appointed for the temple. The book of Deuteronomy, on the other hand, in the temple scroll version, the idea is that it's the entire law of Moses, but instead of in the exile or desert context, it is in the temple context. So this is the ultimate fulfillment of the law. That's what it presents to us. And the other thing I want to say is that, does the temple scroll only have Deuteronomy? Basically, the temple scroll is what I believe is the original version of Deuteronomy, but it has many extra laws, and a lot of these laws can be found in Exodus, can be found in Leviticus, can be found in Numbers, can be found in other books of the Old Testament, like Ezekiel, you know, all these other books. It's having these extra commandments as part of the book of the law. And so what I discovered by comparing the temple scroll with what we have in the law of Moses is that the temple scroll follows very, very closely with Exodus and Leviticus. So for and the question was asked, am I saying that the temple scroll is Deuteronomy but has more detail than the version we are used to? Yes, that's exactly what I'm saying. It has much more detail, and it's often in a very different order, so it has extra commandments. And when you look at the temple scroll, what does it start out with? It starts out with laws for how to build a temple. Well, let's look at Exodus, where the laws start in Exodus. Laws about how to build the tabernacle. Then what follows in the temple scroll? Laws for how to do the sacrifices and how to do the festivals. And that's what we see in Exodus. We see following this are the festivals, laws about how to keep the festivals. And then, and Leviticus, the beginning of Leviticus is laws of sacrifices. So as I said, the temple scroll, after laws for how to build a temple, it starts discussing laws of the holy days and the sacrifices. And so we see in Exodus, it's the holy days that come after. And then starts up in Leviticus, the beginning of Leviticus, those are the sacrifice laws. Then in the temple scroll, it also gives laws of the courtyards after that to build the area of the temple. But in that, moving out of that section, it starts giving laws in the temple scroll of laws for uncleanness. This will make you unclean. This will make you unclean, you know, to that. In Leviticus, what do we see happen next? Laws for uncleanness start. And it goes all the way until Leviticus chapter 15. All that's laws for uncleanness. So like five chapters of Leviticus straight in a row are laws for uncleanness. Then we see laws in temple scroll of proper respect of sacrifices and burying the burying blood, and that's what we see in the temple scroll, and we see that in the book of Leviticus. That's what comes next. Laws for burying blood. On the, it comes in, I think it's Leviticus chapter 16 or 17 or something like that. But so it's following very closely, and it gives laws. Let's see what comes after that. It gives laws for rooting out other gods from your nation. And also, it starts saying, don't consult magicians and things like that, you know. And Leviticus also goes right into that next. And then the temple scroll ends with laws of justice and laws of sexuality, proper sexuality. The Leviticus does the same thing, but it's slightly reversed. It's like it's like in the opposite order, but it's still, it's closely connected. So the general order of both are closely following each other, and this just to me is very compelling and suggests that the temple scroll makes much more sense with the context of the law and flows with the idea of wait, hold on. Someone's calling in on Skype. Can you hear me? All right, can you mute your side? Can you mute your side? Or I can just let's see. Hope, tell me if you can still. Can you hear me? All right. So oh, and the other thing I wanted to say was Deuteronomy, according to the scholars, is not the original version. Even the scholars admit it. They say that the Torah has been tampered with. The scholars say that there's evidence of editing, late editorial things. So if the scholars are saying that the Torah has been changed from the original version, what if? You know, what if the Temple Scroll is in fact the original version? And the evidence is, to me, is strongly pointing that this is the case. If there ever was an original version of a book of Deuteronomy, for instance, that was, according to scholars, the current one is in a late stage of editing, and if there was an original version, the Temple Scroll is it. It has marks of authority, and it's very powerful and inspiring to me. And you also have to realize that this writer who wrote the Temple Scroll presents it as Yahuwah himself speaking to Moses. If this was written by someone who knew that this was not divinely inspired, or if he knew that this was fake and he was just making things up, then he would knowingly be like doing something that he knew to be like incredibly blasphemous, because he, according to their law, according to the religion of Judaism, you know, adding to the words and claiming, you know, presenting yourself as a prophet and speaking in the name of Yahweh when he's not speaking to you makes you a false prophet and makes you deserve the death penalty. And when you read the Temple Scroll, it is extremely strict and rigorous Judaism. So it seems kind of hard to believe that a Jew that did not take the law seriously wrote it and tried to make people take the law seriously. It just seems very strange concept. So, but anyways, that's the overall presentation of it. Unfortunately, the Temple Scroll breaks off in our copy that we have. It breaks up at the end, and the rest of it's incomplete. But I have a good approximation of what the rest of it said. A very interesting fact is that the Temple Scroll is the longest scroll preserved of the entire Dead Sea Scrolls, the longest one, and so there's a lot in there. And what convinced me it was the Book of Deuteronomy was I started going through in the beginning sections. There's 66 columns of the Temple Scroll preserved. The first, I would say, 45 columns have like no relationship at all to the Book of Deuteronomy. So if you read the first 45 columns, you wouldn't make the connection to Deuteronomy. But then, starting in the late 40 columns, what we see is a version of Deuteronomy chapter 14, which is extremely altered. It has many of the same verses, but in a very different order and much fuller, like many more laws for uncleanness. Then, after Deuteronomy chapter 14, what follows next? What follows next, immediately after, is a version of Deuteronomy chapter 12. But once again, this version in the Temple Scroll that was found has the verses of chapter 12 mixed up, rearranged, and not only this, but it has verses from all over Deuteronomy, and also extra stuff too. Like, it has verses from like chapter 14, chapter 15, chapter 16, chapter 17, chapter, you know, all these different chapters, chapter 23, like all over the place. Like, whoa, like, you know, he's taking it all over. Like, I call it the mishmash chapter. And so it's just that there's a lot of information in there, and some of the extra laws come from other parts of the Torah, like the Book of Numbers, for instance, in that longer chapter 12 section. Then here's where it starts getting really interesting. After that comes Deuteronomy chapter 13 in its entirety, almost identical to the text that we have. There are some differences. Extra letters here and there, maybe a word here and there that's not in one or the other, but it's basically equivalent to chapter 13 of Deuteronomy. Following chapter 13 of Deuteronomy in the Temple Scroll, immediately comes Deuteronomy chapter 17, the entirety of it. The entire Deuteronomy chapter 17 comes. Then, leaving off from Deuteronomy chapter 17 refers to a book of the law for the king, a law of the king that the priests were to write. Many people say that this law for the king that was to be written is the entire law of Moses, but this is not true. It's actually the law for the king, as 1 Samuel, for instance. 1 Samuel quotes and refers to this book of the law of the king, and these laws that Samuel says was in this book, the same laws are in the Temple Scroll. So Samuel had a version of the law which corresponded with the Temple Scrolls, Book of the Law, of the king. So when we look at this law for the king, it is like very amazing. It covers it's a very thorough law of how the king is to rule. It gives a good system of government. It gives checks and balances. You know, the king is not to be an absolute king, absolute monarchy, but he's never to go to war unless he gets permission from the priest first. They have to approve it first. You know, a lot of these things are very similar to some of what we're seeing in the American Constitution, the separation of powers, the three branches of government. But so it's the Temple Scrolls version of the law for the king and the laws for how the king is to rule is so much superior than what we see in Deuteronomy. But so after the law for the king is like about the equivalent of something like 2 or 3 chapters long. And then what comes after that is a version of, immediately after that comes Deuteronomy chapter 18, almost identical, except there's one passage that's fuller and has like a longer reading, but otherwise it's the same thing. And immediately following chapter 18, most of Deuteronomy chapter 19 is completely missing. It's skipped over from one verse to the next verse in the Temple Scroll. It goes from the end of chapter 18 all the way to like verse 15 or something like that of chapter 19, and then it finishes chapter 19, and then it goes into chapter 20, and it pretty much gives the entirety of chapter 20, and then immediately following that in the Temple Scroll, chapter 21, and then immediately following that in the Temple Scroll is chapter 22. So we're seeing, wow, like look at that, it's a enlarged, rearranged version of Deuteronomy 14, then following that in a large, rearranged version of Deuteronomy 12, and then following that is chapter 13, chapter 17, the Law of the King, chapter 18, a little bit of chapter 19, and then chapter 20, 21, and 22. But then the Temple Scroll breaks off at the end of chapter 22, and so the rest of it is missing, but you know, the rest of it would have continued with the laws of chapters 23 to 26. And so that's the basic overview of it. So it's very powerful. Now, what I wanted to do in this study is to basically go through with you all the I'm going to read different passages of the Temple Scroll so that you can hear it for yourself and see, wow, this is powerful words, and you know, to, it's basically to whet your appetite and get you really interested in this book, and you can study it on your own in the future. So start by reading the closest portions of Deuteronomy, just so you can see how it corresponds. So I'm going to start with what corresponds with Deuteronomy chapter 13, and so let me just get to that page. So where I'm starting is column, and I have PDFs of the Temple Scroll so that you can follow along in, or you can look at it on your own time to look up these passages yourself. So let's see. All right, so it starts in column 54, and I'm going to read now. all the things which I order you today, you shall take care to do. You shall not add to them, and you shall not subtract from them. If a prophet rises up from among you, or a dreamer of dreams, and gives to you a sign or wonder, and it actually occurs for you, the sign or wonder which he declared to you, saying, let us go and serve other gods which you have not known, you shall not listen to the word of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams, for I am testing you to know whether you continue loving Yahuwah, God of your fathers, with all your heart and with all your soul. After Yahuwah your God, you shall go, and him you shall serve, and him you shall revere, and to his voice you shall listen, and to him you shall cling. And that prophet or dreamer of dreams shall be put to death, for he spoke a falsehood against Yahuwah your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And I ransomed you from the house of slavery, to mislead you from the way which I am ordering you to go. And you shall remove the evil from among you. And if one urges you, your brother, the son of your father, or the son of your mother, or your son, or your daughter, or the wife of your bosom, or your soulmate, secretly saying, let us go and serve other gods whom you have not known, it breaks off here, and there are five lines missing. And then it picks up again, it says, among you, and then in the next line we see, it's a little bit breaking up here. If you hear in one, and then it says, I am giving you to dwell. So those are fragmentary lines. But then line three says, and it, from here on out to the end of the column, it is preserved, like, essentially full, perfectly. And it says, that says, sorry, it's raining and thundering in the background. That says, men, sons of Belial, have emerged from among you, and have misled all the inhabitants of their city, saying, let us go and serve gods, whom you have not known. Then you shall ask, investigate, and inquire carefully. And indeed, if it is established as true, that this abomination has been done in Israel, you shall surely slay all the inhabitants of that city by the sword. It is under the ban and all that is in it. All its domesticated animals you shall slay by the edge of the sword, and all its pillage you shall collect in the midst of its plaza, and you shall burn with fire the city and its pillage, a whole offering for Yahuwah your God. And it shall be a rubble forever, it shall never be rebuilt. And nothing shall cling in your hand from that which is under the ban, so that I shall turn away my fierce anger, and grant you mercy, and have compassion on you, and multiply you, as I said to your fathers. If you listen to my voice to keep all my ordinances, which I am ordering you today to do, the upright and the good before Yahuwah your God. Now, second. Okay, so that's the end of chapter 13, where the temple scroll corresponds. Someone asked the question. It says soulmate. The translation I'm reading from, I thought it would be a little. This is one of the more up to date translations, but unfortunately, the way they translate is a little unique compared to others. So, the other versions, like, they translate it something like, who is equal to you or something. So there's different ways to translate it. But so what I just read there, that's in the temple scroll, and it corresponds with Deuteronomy. And what I discovered by going through in detail the Hebrew text of Deuteronomy chapter 13, what I discovered is that there are some surprising, for instance, the Masoretic text, the normal Hebrew text of Deuteronomy, has some extra words that are not in the Temple Scroll version. So we see that some of the scribes added some words sometimes, and then we see words are missing too, words here and there. And what's amazing is that some of the peculiarities of the of the Septuagint version of Deuteronomy match the Temple Scroll, and none of the other versions do. So it makes the Septuagint of a much more importance, seeing it has a connection with the Temple Scroll. And we also see the Samaritan version have a connection with the Temple Scroll as well. So I'm just going to, let's see here. I'm just going to give an example of a couple words that I've read, which are not in our version. So one of them was in verse 3, and it was, our version just says, Yahuwah, your God, but the Temple Scroll says, Yahuwah, God of your fathers, of your fathers. So it has the words of your fathers, which is not in our version. Then we see in verse 6, it says, in the Temple Scroll, it says, if thy brother, the son of thy father, or the son of thy mother, or thy son, or thy daughter, or the wife of thy bosom, or thy friend, which is as thine own soul. So right there. In the regular Hebrew text of the Masoretic, it says, if thy brother, the son of thy mother. It does not say, the son of thy father, or the son of thy mother. It just says, the son of thy mother. So that's an error, and that doesn't make sense. But guess what? The Temple Scroll has the parallel, the father or mother. The Septuagint has father or mother. And the Samaritan text has the father or mother reading. So right there we see the Masoretic text is showing many flaws, which the other versions of Deuteronomy don't have all those flaws. And so it's making the Masoretic text, the regular Hebrew, we're showing that there are some errors in it and inferior readings. In verse 14, at the very end of verse 14, our version just says that such abomination is wrought. In the Temple Scroll, it says in Israel, wrought in Israel, the words in Israel. And then also at the very end, the final verse, 18, where it says, to do that which is right and good before me, Yahuwah, thy God. In the Masoretic text, it just says, that which is right, that which is right. But in the Septuagint and the Masoretic text, the Septuagint and the Samaritan, it says, that which is right and good. And so it corresponds with the Temple Scroll once again. So there's many examples of this throughout. Now let me just check a couple things that people are saying in the comments. Let's see here. Yeah, someone asked, is the Septuagint better than the Masoretic text? Generally, yes, but there are many exceptions to this. So you can't say flat out the Septuagint is always better. Plus, the Septuagint, as we have it, is not the original Septuagint. There have been alterations over time by the scribes. So, and the question was, a suspicion of the Masoretic text into other books as well. Yes, what I found is that comparing the manuscripts that we have, comparing the Septuagint with the Masoretic text, and then also throwing in the Dead Sea Scrolls as another witness, what we find is that for many of these books, the Masoretic text is greatly inferior for certain books. For other books, the Masoretic is kind of on the same page with the Septuagint, and then in some instances the Masoretic is actually better. So like the book of Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1 and 2 Chronicles, Ecclesiastes, let's see, like those ones right there, those are, the Septuagint and the Masoretic are pretty close to one another, but the ones which are most different, which I find the most radical differences, are Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, of course, which we're discussing. 1 and 2 Samuel, that's really different. 1 and 2 Kings, pretty different. Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Proverbs. In all those, in the Book of Psalms, that's one of the big ones. In all of those, I believe the Septuagint is much more reliable. It has many more passages, much more. Then in other, like a couple books like Job and Jeremiah, those are very poorly preserved in the Septuagint as compared to the Masoretic. So it's a, you know, I have to take it on a case by case basis, but it just shows that the Masoretic, we have to suspect certain, we have to be suspicious of certain readings in the Masoretic text, especially when we have older and more compelling readings of other copies that have been found. And let's see here, was there anything else people were saying? The King James was mostly translated from a version that closely corresponded with the Masoretic text. Here and there, in a few readings, they took a couple of readings from like Vulgate or Septuagint, things like that. But otherwise, the King James version was pretty much a translation of the Masoretic text. The Latin Vulgate and the Aramaic Peshitta, those are basically the Masoretic text. They're pretty close to the Masoretic text. There's some, you know, a few important differences, but for the most part, you don't really need to read those other ones because they correspond pretty closely with Masoretic. Sometimes here and there they come a little closer to the Septuagint, but otherwise they're basically Masoretic. But so anyways, going back to the temple scroll information, and I'm going to go on. Now notice where I left off, where it talks about destroying the city where there's false prophets in it, okay? So what immediately following is not verse 1 of chapter 17, but verse 2 of chapter 17. Verse 1 of chapter 17 occurred in another place. But so this is from the temple scroll, and I shall read. So, if it is found among you within one of your gates, which I am giving to you, a man or woman who does what is evil in my eyes, violating my covenant, and goes and serves other gods and worships them, or the sun or the moon or all the army of heaven, and it is related to you about it, and you have heard of this thing, and you have investigated and inquired carefully, and behold, if established as true, the report, this abomination has been done in Israel, then you shall take out that man or that woman, and you shall pelt them with stones. It breaks off there, and there are, there are 5 lines missing, and then it picks up again, and says, or to the judge, those days, and they shall investigate, and then the next line, the matter which you went up, breaks it up a little bit, and then they shall relate to you the judgments, and from here on out, until the end of the column, it reads fully. So this is chapter 17, I'm going through the, but it's the temple scroll version, okay? And so, they shall relate to you the judgments, and you shall act on the authority of the teaching which they shall relate to you, and on the authority of the word which they shall speak to you from the book of the teaching. And they shall relate to you truthfully from the place which I shall choose to cause my name to dwell upon it. And you shall take care to do according to everything you are taught. And on the authority of the judgment which they speak to you, you shall do. You shall not turn aside from the teaching which they shall relate to you. right or left. And the person who does not listen and acts with presumption, not listening to the priest standing there to serve before me, or to the judge, that person shall be put to death. And you shall remove the evil from Israel, and all the people shall listen and revere, and they shall not behave presumptuously again in Israel. When you enter the land which I am about to give to you, and you inherit it and dwell in it, and you say, let me place a king over me as all the nations which are around me, there you will place over you a king whom I shall choose. From among your brothers you shall place over you a king. You shall not set over you a foreign man who is not your brother. Only he shall not multiply for himself horse, and he shall not return the people to Egypt for battle in order to multiply for himself horses and silver and gold. And I myself say to you, you shall not again return that way forever. And he shall not multiply for himself wives, and they shall not turn aside his heart from after me. And he shall not greatly multiply for himself silver and gold. And when he is sitting upon the throne of his kingdom, then they shall write for him this teaching in a book in the presence of the priests. And it breaks off there. And so, first I will say a couple readings of chapter 17 in the Temple Scroll version, which are important to know. And then I'm going to kind of just give some information about the two chapters I just read from the Temple Scroll, Deuteronomy 13 and 17. So let's see here. So in verses like, it's hard to say because the verses are, there's a couple verses where the scroll starts up again. When you compare it to Deuteronomy, a couple verses were rearranged. But the way the Temple Scroll reads makes much more sense. It flows better. And they shall inquire the matter about which you come to investigate. So the words, the matter about which you come to investigate, that's not in the Masoretic text. And then there's also where it says, so for instance, it says, and thou shalt do according to the sentence which they inform thee, and according to the sentence of the law which they shall teach thee from the book of the law. So what's significant about that is the words from the book of the law are not in any other version of Deuteronomy. So what do we think happened? It's very likely that, you know, the rabbis who liked their oral laws, their extra laws that they wanted to impose on people, removed that to give them more leverage, more power over the people. So from the book of the law, that's kind of limiting the authority here. So the Temple Scroll limits authority. And so it says, you shall do according to the sentence which they inform thee, and according to the sentence of the law which they shall teach thee from the book of the law. So it has to be in accordance with the law. It can't be these extra laws that are contrary to the law or don't have any validity. And then it says, in the Temple Scroll says, they shall tell it to thee accurately from the place I shall choose to make my name dwelling upon it. Thou shalt be careful to observe, to do according to all that they inform thee. So let's take a look at that for a second. So, our version just simply says, they shall tell it to thee, it doesn't say accurately from. And then, again, as I said, the Temple Scroll has Yahuwah speaking in the first person, Deuteronomy never has that. And so we see where he said, the place I shall choose to make my name dwelling upon it. The regular Deuteronomy just says, you know, the place that the Lord thy God or something like that will choose. And it does not have the words to make my name dwelling upon it. So we're seeing an abbreviation here, some laziness of the scribes. And to further support this, in the very next clause of the sentence, it says in the temple scroll, "Thou shalt be careful to observe to do." In Masoretic and the other copies, it just says, "Thou shalt observe." Well, observe means to watch, right? Or, you know, to keep. And careful has a very similar idea of watching, you know, to take care to it. So it seems kind of repetitive. Take care to, or be careful to observe. Well, you could, you know, to shorten it, you could just say observe, and it conveys the same idea. And we see all throughout the temple scroll, we see examples of this, where the temple scroll has the fuller detail, even if it, you know, seems repetitive, and some people might argue unnecessary, but the scriptures, from what I've seen, in the original forms, like to be as full and consistent as possible, and they didn't like to take shortcuts and clip passages for the sake of scribes having it easier or making it not as long a text. So we see examples all throughout where the temple scroll has the longer reading, and it's pretty clear that our copies of Deuteronomy have abbreviated it to shorten the length. And we see something like this happen in other books of the scriptures of the Bible as well. One of the main examples is the Book of Job, where I mentioned to you the Book of Job is much inferior in the Septuagint version. The reason for that is when you look on many of those instances, there's something called parallelism, where Job or one of his companions says something, he makes a statement, and then he rewords it in a very similar way. It's called parallelism, giving the two phrases which correspond to each other. The Septuagint Job was like, no. We've got two phrases saying basically the same thing. Do we really need them both? Not really. Take one out, you leave the one in there, and it conveys the same idea. Like, you know, that's what they were thinking. And you see this all throughout the Book of Job in the Septuagint version. There's so many parallel instances where the Masoretic has both parallel, but the Septuagint just has one or the other. So there's a lot of evidence of tampering, the scribes editing it to put it into a form that was more applicable and relevant to people and more accessible to the public. Now the question was, why did they change the tenses from I and my to Yahweh and your God? I believe the reason for that is, so here's my theory, is that when the Israelites came back from exile, they wanted to build a temple, right? They wanted to build a temple. Well, who wanted to help them? The Samaritans wanted to help them. They wanted to help them build a temple, right? So clearly, if they wanted to help them build a temple, that they did not have their special temple yet. So they wanted to help, and the Israelites were like, no, we're not accepting your help. Sorry, we don't trust you guys. So what did the Samaritans do? What we find out in history, they went and built their own temple somewhere else. And so it seems to me that the Samaritans took the version of the temple scroll, the original version of Deuteronomy, and they removed all the laws for the temple and the priesthood that contradicted their understanding of what they wanted for the priesthood and what they wanted for the temple. So the Samaritans built their temple, they had their priesthood, so they didn't want to keep all those laws of the temple. But much of Deuteronomy they liked, and so they removed all those priestly stuff that was unnecessary to them. And then but the problem is when you remove a passage from a concentrated passage, you know, it'll start, like, it won't make sense. There'll be broken sentences. The sentences are broken. So what has to be done? Words have to be added so that the sentence can be completed and make sense. And then there's a context of, for instance, the temple scroll in the original version, you know, at one point must have said, and then Yahuwah spoke to Moses saying, and then he started saying, you know, etc. But we don't see a transition like that in the edited version the Samaritans did. So all you see is Moses talking, and then all of a sudden Yahweh's talking. And that doesn't make sense. There needs to be a transition. So it seems to me that they decided to edit it to make it agree with the context of the preceding chapters of Moses speaking. And then, several generations later, the Jews, what happened to them? Their temple was not in obedience to the temple scroll either. The laws of the temple for the second temple are not corresponding to the correct way. So it seems to me that the and their sacrifices and their priesthood was not following the temple scroll laws. So imagine if you have a book with tedious laws, really lengthy laws about how to do the priesthood and the sacrifices and the temple, but it's for a temple that you don't have. It's for a system of priesthood that you're not, that none of the priests are following, and sacrifices that are contrary to the way you're doing the sacrifices. It's not relevant, and scribes would consider it a waste of time copying something that has no application to them. So they would have had reason to either, if my theory is correct, that the Samaritans were the ones responsible for originating the shortened version, they would have had motivation to take from the Samaritans, or otherwise the Jews would have had motivation just on their own to make their own version that was compatible and palatable to their own temple. So that's why I believe that it was changed. Now, hold on, there was another question. It's like, let's see. The temple scroll has much more concern for the welfare of Israel in general, but it also has concern for the welfare of other nations too, in certain instances, which is kind of interesting. Like, as I said, it gives that limitation. Don't go to war against nations unless the priesthood says to. Well, how many of, in the Old Testament, how often did the kings go to war without the permission of the priesthood? Very often, and they killed a lot of people, a lot of bloodshed, and made a lot of innocent lives die. If they, you know, so the temple scroll is more compassionate to other nations in many instances, and let's see here. Yeah, so let's see, what do I want to say next? Okay, so for instance, another example of where repetitive readings are condensed in the Masoretic text, but in the temple scroll it's fuller. Here's an example. In the passage I read, so it says, "And the man that will not listen, who will do presumptuously, and will not hearken unto the priest that standeth to minister." So the words "will not listen," "who," are not in our version. They're in the temple scroll. So you see that the temple scroll says, "The man that will not listen and will not hearken." Not listen, not hearken. It's the same basic idea. So it seems more likely that a scribe would remove, we don't need that, that's like basically the same thing, rather than a scribe adding a what seems to be unnecessary verb. You know, unnecessary verb, why add it there? It makes much more sense that the two verbs were there originally and then one was removed because it was figured to still be sufficient. So, hold on 1 second. I just got to step out for just like 10 seconds. 1 second. Sorry about that. Okay. Oh, and by the way, can you see this in the background? Um, I made this, and this is a, see if I can, it's too blurry, you said? Okay, let's see here, oops, it's like, yeah, it's kind of hard to show, but, it's basically the dimensions of the temple and the courtyards that the temple scroll commands, and I had a hard time figuring out because I'm not an architect, so you know it's very difficult to understand the language being used. So it took me a long time, but I was able to come to a basic understanding of what I believe it's describing, and I knew I was gonna forget it all unless I wrote it down. So I wrote it down, and that's my preservation of the work that I did. One reading in the law of the king, or excuse me, in the passage we read, it says, "Nor cause the people to return to Egypt on account of war to the end that he should multiply horses and the silver and gold." The Masoretic text, the other versions, say, doesn't say on account of war, and doesn't say, and the silver and gold. So it makes it sound like to me that the Jews wanted to, they believed it was okay to, don't cause the people to return to Egypt to the end that he should multiply horses. But the Jews were thinking, well, you know, we can return to Egypt to fight them in war, though. That's okay. So it makes it sound, you know, it's on account of war. It makes it sound like we should never fight war with Egypt. That's what they were probably thinking. So they basically removed certain words that make it easier to invade Egypt and persecute Egypt. So and there's a question was asked. I'll answer that in a second. And again, like one of the characterizations of Jews, not trying to be racist here, but one of the common accusations, I'll say, or generalizations, is that Jews are greedy. Well, here we have this passage of, don't return the people to Egypt to the end that he should multiply horses, but in the temple scroll it says, and the silver and gold. So, don't return to Egypt to multiply silver or gold. But the Masoretic version doesn't say that. So, they might think, well, you know, for silver and gold, let's do it. Or, you know, like that's the thing. So, it's a little bit stricter in the temple scroll. So, that's an interesting thing. Now, the question was asked, what are the most important points of the law that are missing the temple scroll? Okay, so I'll give you a little bit of an overview of that. Extra laws for uncleanness. So there's certain laws of uncleanness that people are not following, which are related in there. Then there are extra holy days. So, you know, extra festivals, extra days you're not supposed to do work on. There's only a few extra days you're not supposed to do work on, but otherwise it's basically the same festivals. And there are extra laws about proper government. So fuller readings of, like, who should we put to death? Well, it talks about corrupt judges. Corrupt judges should be put to death. It doesn't say that in our version, but it does in the temple scroll. So there's stricter law, more righteous system of government, and it flows much better. It's the entirety of the concept of the law, you know, everything together. And the law for the king, that's important because of the significance for how it relates to other portion of the Old Testament, because if the law of the king is true, then that, as we suggested, you know, David was not following the temple scroll regulation. So if the temple scroll is the original, then David was out of line. He was not following the Torah properly. So that's a very significant issue. And then there's also laws for sexuality and marriage, extra laws for that are important. So I would say those are the most important in a sense of applicability in what is still applies to us. But in terms of divinely inspired words, it's like every word, I believe every letter, every word that was truly divinely inspired is significant. So if we have a whole bunch missing, that's significant. Even if it's not necessarily relevant for us in the sense we're not priests, so we can't build a temple ourselves. But it's all about, a lot of this is about beliefs and what we support. Whose side are you on? Are you going to support Yahuwah's way of what he wants? And so it's kind of like your hopes and dreams. We want our hopes and dreams to be in line with Yahuwah's. We should hope and dream for the temple that the temple scroll commands to be built one day and the priesthood to be done. If we're not, I would argue that we're going against what God wants, and or at the very least, we're going against the temple scroll. The temple scroll has the vision of this is the temple that needs to be built. We need to build this, people. So if you're not helping in that, like by supporting it or being a believer in it, then even though you're not the one responsible for the temple, in a sense you're responsible for it not being built. Because the more people that support this temple, the sooner it can be built, and the sooner we can restore and keep the entire law. And a question was asked of, did David have the temple scroll laws? And the answer to that, at least according to the Dead Sea Scrolls, is no, he did not. The law of Moses, the temple scroll, had been locked away in the Ark of the Covenant. And what happens in the time of David? The Ark of the Covenant is stolen by the Philistines, and they don't get the Ark of the Covenant back until the very end of David's life. And the Dead Sea Scroll says that David did not have access to the law, so he was not, his heart was pure, and he wasn't accountable to it because he did not have a way of knowing what the law required of him. And until it says that when the Ark was returned at the end of David's life, the law was discovered and published and shown to the people. So that was by Zadok, it says. The Dead Sea Scroll says Zadok, the priest, did that. So I trust what the Dead Sea Scrolls say there, and that's the correct version of the story. And let's see. And what's different about marriage? The question was asked in the temple scroll, what's different about marriage? Well, one of the differences is like who to marry. Like you're not supposed to marry your, in the temple scroll it says don't marry your niece. Well, in our version of Torah, there's no law, don't marry your niece, you know, don't take her to be your wife. So what did the Jews do? What did the Pharisees do? They say, oh, look, it only says don't take the aunt, but it doesn't say don't take the niece. So guess what they believe? They believe it's not a sin to marry your niece. But according to the original law of the temple scroll, it is a violation. And there's so many examples of what they call minutiae, which is, you know, small details of laws and ritual of the temple scroll, which contradict the oral laws of the Pharisees. There's so many differences. So, you know, there's not so much a way of reconciling the oral law with the temple scroll in most instances. There's just too many contradictions. And there was another one that some people like to appeal to a passage which in Deuteronomy as saying of, it basically says if a man sleeps with a woman that's not betrothed, he has to marry her. And people who are supporters of polygamy say, oh, look, he has to marry her. So, but what if he what if he already has a wife? So he has to marry her. So, you know, that so that's supporting of polygamy. However, in the Temple Scroll, in that very passage, it says he must, like it says something to the effect of, if she is, if he is allowed to marry her, or, you know, like if she is marryable to him, like, you know, something along those lines. I'm basically saying, no, it's not automatically he has to marry her if he sleeps with her. It's if they are able to be married according to the law, then there's, then he has to marry her, unless the father refuses. And yeah, and then the law was lost again. The law was lost again, and Josiah found the book of the law later on. So the book of the law had been completely lost. And most scholars agree that the book of the law that Josiah found was Deuteronomy in some form. And so we have to think, you know, if the law, the book of the law, according to the Bible, was one time, it was lost. So if it was lost once, it could be lost again. You know, we can't say, no, that couldn't happen. Because if he let it happen once, who's to say he would not let it happen again? We can't do that. So, and there are so many similarities with, like, how the scroll of the book of the law was found and how the temple scroll was found. It just is like, it really seems, you know, like how history repeats itself. Well, it really seems like Yahuwah orchestrated the temple scroll to be rediscovered once again for the people, just as it was in Josiah. One of the most amazing things is that when the temple scroll was found, the Arabs kept it. They didn't want to give it away because they wanted money. You know, they were greedy. They were selling all the scrolls for money, and they kept the temple scroll in themselves. Israel became a nation in 1948. That's when the Dead Sea Scrolls were first discovered, 1948. And then for the next 7 or 8 years, more caves of the scrolls were found. The Temple Scroll was found in the final cave in 1956. In 1967, so 11 years, the Temple Scroll was inaccessible because they weren't handing it over. The Arabs were not giving it away. Israel fought a 7-day war, or a 6-day war, excuse me, 6-day war. It's called a 6-day war. That's what the name that they give it for. And in that war, they recaptured Jerusalem. But Israel considered the Temple Scroll to be so important, one of the chief commanders of the military made a special trip or mission going into the area and forcibly taking the Temple Scroll from the Arabs. So during the war, so it's very significant that, you know, is it coincidence? Maybe it's coincidence, but or maybe it's indicative of this was orchestrated. And basically, so in other words, the Temple Scroll was found in the same week that Jerusalem was restored. And the temple was supposed to be built in Jerusalem. So how do we build a temple? Well, we don't have the full laws of how to build a temple, but look what happened at the very time Jerusalem was recaptured. They recaptured the Temple Scroll. And tells you, you know, this is how you build the temple. Of course, it is very fragmentary, but enough is there to give some very good information of how to build it. And using other sources that we have, we can have a very confident approach to how to build that temple. And so I am strongly of the conviction that the Temple Scroll was orchestrated. The discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls and the Temple Scroll was orchestrated by God, because it's so important to what it does to our scholarship and our understanding of our own faith and religion, and our past, our, you know, And so, let's see. There was a question, is there an accurate list of the law based on the temple scroll? There's nothing I'm aware of. I've done some list of laws before, but there's nothing like full comprehensive. And then, okay, a question was asked, why did Yahweh allow Solomon to build the temple? Now, I see it looks like the second temple, but Solomon didn't build the second one. He built the first temple. And David was he was a man after Yahuwah's heart. And David so pleased and satisfied Yahuwah that he wanted, he blessed David's family to have the kingdom forever, and that he wanted David's family to be the one that would build the temple, because David was basically one of his best friends. He was so close to him, so much desiring for his heart, that he chose Solomon to build it. And because Solomon was very wise, so he would be able to know how to build it, and he also would be able to know how to get help from other nations. He would know how to negotiate with other nations to get them cooperative. And there's something else that's interesting too. That's not it's in one of the extra books, which I actually do accept as scripture. It's called The Testament of Solomon, and in it, Solomon actually uses demons to build the temple, of Yahuwah. And so, you know, so you ask the question, you know, why would Yahuwah allow Solomon to build the temple? Well, one might ask, if the Testament of Solomon's story is true, of the demons helping, why would, you know, it would seem much worse to let the demons do it. And yet, according to this other source, you know, that's what he did. He made, he had the demons assist Solomon building it. They were basically made into slaves and subjected. Like, you know how the Messiah in the New Testament, he subjects the demons and tells them to, whatever he tells them to do, they have to do it. That's the same idea that Solomon was sort of like a messianic almost type of figure and was having authority over demons and telling them what they had to do. But so, so a question was asked, why was the Book of the Law put on the side of the Ark of the Covenant and only the 10 words put between the cherubim? That's a good question, and I would have to think about that. I mean, I could try to, you know, give an answer on the spot, but I don't want to, you know, it's like there's a danger of giving an answer under pressure where you're just trying to, you know, make yourself look good to people. You're coming with like the first things that make sense to you that come to your head, but we try to be careful not to do that. So I would say I have to figure out why that is. But in my understanding, it was not the Ten Commandments or the Ten Words that was put into the Ark. On those tablets was not just the 10 words, but it was, maybe I'm incorrect on this, but I'm of the understanding that it was the, like the 10 commandments from Exodus 20 to 23, all of that is like the 10 commandments in greater detail. So do not steal, and then gives laws of how to, you know, don't steal. And then, like different laws of the Ten Commandments are related, described in Exodus chapters 20 to 23. So I think it's very likely that Book of the Covenant, it's called the Book of the Covenant, was put in the Ark, and then the Book of the Law was put on the side. And the question is, why was there that difference? And I don't know why there was that difference, but What I do know is that the Book of the Covenant in Exodus doesn't give laws about how to be saved. It doesn't give laws of, if I remember correctly, it doesn't give laws of, like, you know, if you don't obey, you're going to be cursed type thing. Whereas the Book of the Law, or the Book of Deuteronomy, does. It gives, you must obey the Torah completely, perfectly, without a flaw, to be saved. If you don't, you will be cursed with all these curses. And so it seems like, you know, the concept of the Messiah needing to be our Savior is compatible with the Book of the Covenant, in the sense that the Book of Covenant doesn't say obey the law to be saved, but the Book of the Law, or the Book of Deuteronomy, says, you know, obey this so that you can be saved. But we realize, according to the New Testament, that we have to obey the law to be saved, but the law cannot save us. The law does not have a system in place to save us. And so when we break the law, we are in need of atonement for our eternal souls, and the law cannot give that to us. Animal sacrifices cannot help us. The system of the law is not able to save us from our sins. The Messiah, on the other hand, he is able to save us, and he brought about the new covenant so that he could make a way for people to have their have their violation of the Torah forgiven if they return to the law in repentance and follow him in faith. Then they will be saved through what? Through the law? No, through faith in him. But they will also be saved by obeying the law. But it's not through the law that they're saved. It's through the Messiah that they're saved. So that their obedience only benefits them for salvation through faith in him, the Messiah. And so the law, doesn't give that salvation for people. So I guess that would be my guess as to why it is. Let's see here. I'm just reading a couple of the things that people said here. This is a question of what I mentioned before of Solomon, the story of Solomon and the demons, and that some of the instructions, wisdom of authority over spirits, looks like black magic. This was stated. There are certain, like, books which claim to be by Solomon, which are black magic, and you don't want to read those books. There's certain, like, the Greater Key of Solomon and the Lesser Key of Solomon, things like that. There are writing. There's also, like, the Sword of Moses and the Key of Moses, or things like that, where there's magic writings that were, like, you know, like dark magic or black magic, which is not good. It seems to me that the Testament of Solomon's magic, as you might refer to it, is more of a in line with what the scriptures approve of, because there's a lot of instances for magic where, you know, it's a blurry line, because if Yahweh does it, it's okay, but if the other, you know, if demons are doing it, or if other gods are doing it, then it's not okay. So, for instance, it says divination. Divination is forbidden. Well, what do we see in the law? We see the Urim and Thummim. Thummim, that's divination. So we're seeing things like that where magic not necessarily wrong if it's being done through the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, through, you know, the right mediums. But if you go through mediums, which are the wrong mediums to go through, then you're violating the law, and that's the magic that we have to avoid, going through evil or demonic mediums. Okay, I think I addressed. All right, and there's one more thing I want to say of someone. Matthew Nolan. Yeah, I'm very much critical of Matthew Nolan's teaching on how the book of the law is not applicable anymore for today. I disagree with that. I do believe there were some of what he says is somewhat true in parts of his teachings, but then he misunderstands certain things, and so I would avoid Matthew Nolan's teachings on the subject of the Book of the Covenant and the Book of the Law, because I believe the scriptures, the prophecies, show that the Book of the Law will be reinstated and restored in full in the Millennial Kingdom. We'll be keeping all the sacrifices again, the priesthood, and I don't think it's a coincidence that the Temple Scroll was restored for us. If we weren't supposed to follow the Book of the Law anymore, I don't think the Temple Scroll would have been revealed to us so miraculously like it has. He wouldn't have given to us something we don't really need. But if he needs us or wants us to build the temple and to follow the Book of the Law, then it makes sense why he orchestrated it to be discovered again for us. And right, Urim and Thummim was divination, but it was approved by Yahuwah, and that the only kind of magic that can be done is something that's approved by Yahuwah, or that's coming from him. So there was a lot of questions there. So I want to say, let's see here. So let me just say this, that what I read in the Temple Scroll, what corresponded with chapter 13 of Deuteronomy, and what corresponded with chapter 17, it flowed together. Like, it flows, talking about, you know, if prophets come to you and tell you to worship other gods, don't follow them, and then destroy the city. But then it goes right into chapter 17, and it's continuing the same subject. It's like perfectly flowing. So it starts talking about where it says, if anyone in your gates, if you find anyone in your gates that transgressed the covenant and gone and served other gods and worshipped them, or they worship the sun, moon, or any of the hosts of heaven, then they are to be killed as well. And so that flows perfectly. Let's see, some more questions here. Yeah, there is a blueprint for the temple construction in the Temple Scroll, but unfortunately, coincidentally, the temple portions were the worst preserved portion of the entire book, of the scroll that was found. So, but what is there has a lot of similarities with Ezekiel, and it has similarities with Kings and Chronicles accounts of the temple construction as well. It corresponds with, you know, as I said, Exodus for the tabernacle. There's some similarities. The Temple Scroll says three courtyards. The Ezekiel says two courtyards, and there's an important reason for that, is that the two courtyards are the ones which are truly holy. The third one is not really, it's a much, much lesser holiness. So the Temple Scroll says that the third courtyard all around is for Gentiles, women, and children. And any Israelites who are only three generations of Israelites. When you have been in the Israelite nation and family for four generations, now you can enter into the second courtyard if you're an adult male. No one else can enter. And then, so that's the second courtyard. That's the Ezekiel. That's where Ezekiel starts. And then the first temple here is, I assume not first temple, the first courtyard is None of the Israelites can go there. The only ones that can go there are Levites. Only Levites can enter that area. And then there's an area where only the priests can enter, the temple itself. And then, the temple itself is very small. It's like only like this size right here. And then the Holy of Holies is only for the high priest, and there's only one high priest. So every time you get closer and closer into the center, it's more and more restricted of who can go in there. So it what we have in the Temple Scroll matches very closely with other documents of scripture, which allows us to have a very complete picture, for the most part, of how the laws of the temple work, of how to build it. And there was a question of, does it, how do the Zadokite priests fit into the temple? Basically, the Zadokite priesthood, there's been a lot of teaching that people have done about that, and basically all it is the word Zadokite in Hebrew, it just means essentially, it means righteous, or made right, and so when it says the Zadokite priesthood, all it's really saying is the priesthood of righteousness, because the righteousness because the priesthood that was being done by the others was unrighteous. As Ezekiel was saying, they let uncircumcised people go in there. They they were doing all these things contrary to the law, contrary to the priesthood commandments. And so Ezekiel was saying, you need to have a righteous priesthood. Sons of righteousness, sons of Zadok. It's not sons of the high priest Zadok. The Torah says sons of Aaron, not sons of Zadok. So it's sons of Aaron and not a man named Zadok, but it has to be sons of righteousness who are circumcised in heart and flesh. That's what Ezekiel says. They must be circumcised in heart and in flesh. And then that makes them sons of righteousness, sons of Zadok, and they can serve in the priesthood if they're sons of Aaron. And the dimensions of the Ezekiel temple vision, yes, it's a very massive. Basically, the temple scroll is also really massive. What you see, Ezekiel does a 500 by 500, which is like, I don't know if you can see it in the background, but it's like this, 500 by 500, okay? And there's like, okay, there's like a, in here, there's like a 280 surrounded by a 300, then there's the 500 by 500 surrounded by a 600 by 600. And what these are basically, it's like an outside section surrounding the courtyard to like separate from the next place to the next courtyard. And so there's a 280 and surrounding it is a 300 by 300. And then there's the 500 by 500 courtyard surrounded by a 600 by 600 area. Then you've got a 1600 cubits by 1600 cubits for the third courtyard. And then the entirety of it, of the outside portion being included, is 1,800 cubits by 1,800 cubits. So if you look at that, the mathematical is very impressive. It's the first courtyard, 1, is 300. The second courtyard, 2, is 600. 300 times 2, second courtyard, is 600 by 600 cubits. And then the third courtyard is 1800 by 1800 cubits. So 600 times 3, 3, third, third courtyard. So the math of the dimensions is very, like, wow, like, you know, it goes together very well. It's very impressive to me. But it's a very huge area. As I said, it was 300 by 300, 600 by 600, and 1800 by 1800. Ezekiel says 500 by 500, but that's referring to the courtyard itself. And then, as I said, there's a 50 cubit area surrounding the entire second courtyard. And together that's a 600 by 600. So, and where do we, you know, where is this supposed to be built? That's, you know, we gotta figure that out before we build it, obviously. So that's important. But it corresponds to sacred geometry. Now, and a question was asked of, does it say anything about combining fabrics or combining crops or foods? Unfortunately, like, the portions are kind of fragmentary in some of those places, but it does give a hint that, you know, like, it has those same laws that Deuteronomy gives laws about, you know, combining stuff. And it does have stuff like that. It also says don't cut yourself and don't paint yourself. In other words, don't get tattoos. You know, don't put marks into your flesh, tattoo, and don't daub yourself or paint marks on your body. That's another concept of tattoos. So there's things like that which are very, don't mix, don't be impure. The temple scroll is very strict in the laws, so that, you know, you would have to assume that it gives the laws of the combining fabrics and the crops. You know, it gives some extra laws about food, for instance. So things like that, where there is some extra information. Let's see here. And also, a lot of people, this is an important thing. People, when Paul says the works of the law, there's a teaching going around saying that when Paul says the works of the law, he's talking about the extra laws of the Essenes, or, you know, what they're trying to say is that the Essenes had their own oral Torah, or their extra traditions, extra laws that weren't valid, and that this was the works of the law that Paul was opposing. However, the Temple Scroll, if it's the original, kind of refutes that interpretation, because most, not all, but most of these extra laws that they're saying have close parallels and sometimes exact correspondences with extra laws in the Temple Scroll. So at least a good majority, a good chunk of the extra laws that the Essenes had was not them making it up, but simply following what they believed the Torah was, the Temple Scroll. It's possible they went a little bit too extreme on the Sabbath. You know, I believe that they were correct on some of on their laws of Sabbath, but I try to interpret it in a way that corresponds with what the Messiah said. But, you know, it's possible there was a couple things where they went a little bit too extreme. But otherwise, the vast majority of it, I would say, matches the spirit of the original law and these extra writings. Like, there's so much connecting there. See. The Holy of Holies was 20 by 20, not 12 by 12. And okay. And do I support what the Temple Institute is doing? I assume you mean like the red heifer thing? No, I don't. It seems to me that they're kind of being silly, like creating a ridiculous requirement that it has to be, like, you know, completely red. Like, I read a very interesting article which basically suggested that the ancients used the word for red did not strictly mean what we consider red. It had a wider range. Like, for instance, blue, the word, the color blue, there's a wide range for that color, especially in ancient times. So, so I would say that a red heifer does not have to be like red, what they're trying to do it, you know, completely red. It could be like more like brown. And, and they're doing it the wrong way. They're trying to force it to happen. You know, if Yahuwah wants us to build a temple, he'll give us a red heifer. We don't need to make it. We don't have to bring it into our own hands by using the genetic alterations and all this stuff, you know. I don't think gene splicing or, you know, however they're doing it, cloning or something, I don't know what they're doing exactly, but it doesn't seem like it would be a pure way of doing it. It wouldn't be a holy way of doing it. Certainly, probably the author of the temple scroll didn't the author of the temple scroll would not have approved of what they're trying to do, I would say. You know, very strict and absolute purity, not a fake purity that they're trying to force into it. Now, all right. So, I want to at least, I don't know how long we will still be doing this. You know, you guys can stay as long as we want to do this. But I want to, at the very least, just read to you guys the law for the king, as has been found in the scroll. And, you know, this is one of the most important parts of the entire temple scroll. So, I'm going to read to you guys now. So, it says, and this is the teaching, a little bit's missing there, the priests. On the day which they make him king, they shall muster the sons of Israel from the age of 20 years until 60 years, according to their divisions. And he shall appoint their heads the officers of thousands, and the officers of hundreds, and the officers of fifties, and the officers of tens, in all their cities. And he shall select for himself from them 1,000, 1,000 from a clan to be with him, 12,000, a man of war who shall not abandon him alone and be seized by the hand of the nations. And all the selected troops which he will choose shall be men of truth who revere God, who hate unjust gain, troops ready for war, and they shall be with him continuously day and night. Those who shall keep him from anything wrong and from a foreign nation, lest he be seized by their hand, and 12 leaders of his people with him, and from the priests 12, and from the Levites 12, who shall sit together with him in order to judge and to teach. And he shall not exalt his heart over them, and he shall not do anything regarding any counsel outside of them. And he shall not take a wife from any of the daughters of the nations, but only from the house of his father shall he take a wife for himself, from the family of his father. And he shall not take another wife besides her, for she alone shall be with him all the days of her life. And if she should die, then he may take for himself another from the house of his father, from his family. And he shall not distort judgment, and he shall not take a bribe to distort righteous judgment, and he shall not covet field or vineyard or any treasure or house or any covetable thing in Israel or rob. It breaks off there. And then it continues five lines later. Six lines are missing. They're men. And when the king hears that any nation or people seeks to rob anything that belongs to Israel, he shall send for the officers of the thousands and for the officers of the hundreds, those stationed in the cities of Israel. He shall send with him 1/10 of the people to go out with him to war against their enemies, and they shall go out with him. And if many people invade the land of Israel, then they shall send with him 1/5 part of the men of war. And if a king and chariot and horse and many people, then they shall send with him 1/3 of the men of war, and 2 parts shall guard their cities and their border, lest a band invade into the midst of their land. And if the war intensifies against him, then they shall send to him 1/2 of the people, the men of the army, and half of the people shall not be cut off from their cities. And if they are victorious over their enemies, and shatter them, and slay them by the edge of the sword, and capture their pillage, then they shall give from it to the king his tenth, and to the priests 1,000th, and to the Levites 100th from everything. And they shall share half of the remainder between those who were seizing in the war and their brothers who were allowed to stay in their cities. And if he goes out to war against his enemies, then a fifth of the people shall go out with him, the men of war and all the troops ready for war. And they shall keep from every impure thing and every indecency and every iniquity and guilt. And he shall not go out until he comes before the high priest and asks him for the judgment of the Urim and the Thummim. Upon his testimony he shall go out, and upon his testimony he shall come in, he and all the sons of Israel who are with him. He shall not go out according to the counsel of his heart until he asks for the judgment of the Urim and the Thummim. Then he shall prosper in all his ways when he goes forth according to the judgment, which five lines are missing. And then, again, actually six lines. And then it continues. And this is the final column for the law of the king. And it says, and they will disperse them into many lands, and there they will be a horror, an example and a mockery and a heavy burden, and wanting in everything. And there they will serve gods made by human hands, wood and stone, silver and gold. And during all this, their cities will be a desolation, and an hissing and a waste. And their enemies will be appalled by them. And in the lands of their enemies, they will groan and cry out because of a heavy yoke. And they will call out, but I will not listen. And they will cry out, but I will not respond to them because of the evil of their actions. And I will hide my face from them, and they will become fodder and plunder and booty without anyone to rescue because of their evil. They broke my covenant and my teaching, their soul loathed, in my teaching, their soul loathed until they became guilty of every guilt. Afterwards, they will return to me with all their heart and with all their soul, according to the words of this teaching. Then I will rescue them from the hand of their enemies, and I will ransom them from the grasp of those who hate them, and I will bring them into the land of their fathers. And I will ransom them, and I will multiply them, and I will rejoice with them, and I will become God for them, and they shall become a people for me. And the king who perverts his heart and eye from my ordinances will never find a person for himself to sit upon the throne of his fathers all the days. For I will forever cut off his seed from ruling ever again over Israel. But if he walks by my statutes and keeps my ordinances and does what is upright and good before me, none of his sons will be cut off from sitting upon the throne of the kingdom of Israel forever. And I will be with him, and I will rescue him from the hand of those who hate him, and from the hand of those seeking his life to destroy it. And I will place all his enemies before him, and he will rule over them as he pleases, and they will not rule over him. I will place him above and not below, the head, not the tail, so that he will continue many days over his kingdom, he and his sons after him. And that's where the book of the law of the king ends, and where that column ends. Now, hold on one second. I just need a quick drink of water. So, one second. I'm back. Sorry. All right, so let's see here. Yeah, so regarding polygamy, when I used to accept the Temple Scroll, when I first accepted the Temple Scroll as scripture, I was still a pro-polygamist, and I had a way of reconciling it, you know, with what I wanted to believe was true. But then I started seeing a lot of evidence, and basically I realized that the Dead Sea Scrolls are right there, where David was innocent because of his ignorance of the law. So he wasn't held accountable to it. And so I just started seeing a lot of my arguments were flawed for polygamy. In the Temple Scroll, as we have it, it says, you know, the king is not to take more than one wife. We don't have that law preserved for the common person, but in the very place where it would have said that, if the Temple Scroll ever did say explicitly, you know, in the laws for who you can be with, you only to have one, in the place it would have said that, that's where the Temple Scroll ends, right at that same place, like where it was about to give you a list of all the people who you can marry. That's where it breaks off, in the middle of that passage. So, in the copy that was found, that's where it ends, unfortunately. The scribe who was copying it didn't finish the rest of the scroll. He ended it. He ran out of space and ended it there. But I would say that one of the biggest arguments in support of polygamy is that David was a polygamist. So, and that other righteous people were polygamists. So that basically the Temple Scroll kind of refutes those arguments. And those are one of the strongest arguments that in support of polygamy. So that someone might be able, as I did in the past, to reconcile a belief of polygamy with the Temple Scroll. You cannot use the argument of David if you accept the Temple Scroll as valid. Let's see. Just look at what people are saying. And so basically the law for the kings in Deuteronomy, it gives the introduction, like it gives a summary. Not to multiply wives, not to multiply, horses and gold and things like that. but it gives a very brief little thing. The Temple Scroll, on the other hand, gives like the full law, and it is much more compelling to me that this is what Allah would have written if they wanted. You know, if you look at, Code of Hammurabi, you know, like they're trying to make a law for the people so that it would be a sufficient system of government. Well, the law as we have it is not a sufficient system for government. It doesn't give the laws for how to do the kingdom. The Temple Scroll, on the other hand, is very sufficient. It gives this full information that's very, very good morality, in my belief anyway, and it has a lot of checks and systems, checks and balances in place. Now, let's see here. Okay. Sorry, 1 second. Yeah, and there's more I could say about the polygamy issue. That's a pretty big topic, so I can address that some other time. But there's good arguments for all the other instances of remember I mentioned the marriage laws, that there's some extra marriage laws. Well, unfortunately, the place where it as I said, where it breaks off, it leaves off, but the Book of Tobit, in the Book of Tobit, it gives some extra information. It gives some extra information about the commandment to marry the widow of your deceased next in line of kin. And that commandment, in the Book of Tobit, it says, the father who does not give up one of the, what was it? Basically, if the people who are required to obey this commandment do not obey it, they will be executed. They must be executed and put to death. that death penalty is not in the Torah. But it makes a lot of sense based on what Genesis says, for instance, how the people who were not doing it were killed. And Jubilees gives a law very similar of if you don't give them in marriage, it's like a capital crime. Okay, and the question was, are there any other books that are included in the temple scroll other than Deuteronomy? Well, basically, the beginning of the scroll and the end of the scroll are missing. The beginning of the scroll starts with laws for how to build a temple, and then starts going, you know, laws for the temple worship, and then it goes right into Deuteronomy chapter, as I said, it starts with 14, then 12, then 13, you know, stuff like that. There's no evidence that has another book, but the point I was trying to make is that the temple scroll has all the laws of it has the laws of the Exodus, Leviticus, and Numbers. It has all those laws essentially, and laws from all throughout the Old Testament. It has some of those extra laws all compacted together in one grand. This is the real book of the law. And this is basically the original version of Deuteronomy. And so Deuteronomy, in original version, the concept is that this was all-encompassing of the entire law. So the Deuteronomy as we have it is the condensed version. The original was, it included everything of obeying the commandments. Not other books. It didn't include other books, but included laws and passages which read very similar to other books. But it was just basically a much longer and fuller version of Deuteronomy. Everyone who's here, can I just kind of get a little bit of a gauge from you all on how much longer you guys want to continue this? I can keep going however long people want me to continue, we have reached not quite 2 hours, but it's, you know, approaching 2 hour mark. So I want to know where everyone stands in their schedules and if they are interested in hearing more, or, you know, if some of you guys are getting tired, we can try to appoint a certain point where once I get to that point, then you guys can decide to leave. Okay. So far we've got like two people that need to go soon. I can keep going. My voice is getting a little iffy, but I can keep doing it. We can take a you know, someone is asking to a brief break for those who want to continue. So I'm just, you know, wondering where can we read the temple scroll? I've done my own special version, so I have it online on Facebook. But there's also versions that the scholars made. And I would recommend first looking at what the scholars did, because that's, you know, that they didn't do as many reconstructions as I did. But then once you see what the scholars say, then you can look at my version and see I show, like, I connect the dots and I put the footnote, or not footnotes, but I put headers to tell you this is from this part of Deuteronomy, this is from this part of Deuteronomy, and the book that I was reading from, you want to know what I was reading? The translation I was reading from is, let's see here, can you see this? That's the Dead Sea Scrolls. There's a series that they were doing, Temple Scroll and Related Documents, Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek Text with English Translations. It's like a series of the Dead Sea Scrolls. They're kind of expensive sometimes, and you can't find this one online. You can only get it in book form. Well, I mean, you could buy an ebook or something, but otherwise it's not available as far as I know online. But there's other versions that are freely available online, PDF files, other scholars' translations that are available. And as I said, my version, which I've done, I need to update it in the future, make some corrections. I've already started going through I've already started going through the Temple Scroll and Deuteronomy again and making it much better. Mine is PDF, yes. So for anyone else, not everyone answered it how long they want to stay. If you want, you can tell me if you have a certain time or, you know, if you're interested in hearing more. But otherwise, the final thing that I'll just tell you guys, for those who have to leave soon, is that there's so many agreements with the law of the king that I just read, and parts all throughout the Old Testament. So you know what? Let me just read a couple things of that. It won't be too long. Just a couple things to give kind of a closure to the Book of the Law subject. And then for those who want to continue, we can continue, and otherwise that's where we will end it for everyone else. So basically, let me find where I have it worded. Let's see here. It's from 1 Samuel, okay? It's going to be a chapter from 1 Samuel, a passage from 1 Samuel. So, this is in 1 Samuel chapter 8, and it reads, verse 4, we're starting. Then all the elders of Israel gathered themselves together and came to Samuel unto Ramah, and said unto him, Behold, thou art old, and thy sons walk not in thy ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, Give us a king. And Samuel prayed unto the Lord. That was up to verse 6. Now, pausing there for a second. And what did Deuteronomy say? And what did the Temple Scroll say? It says, When thou art come into the land which I giveth thee, and shall possess it, and shall dwell therein, and shall say, I will set a king over me, like as all the nations that are about me. That's the same thing that they just said to Samuel. So it's clear that it's connecting it with this book of the law of the king. So 1 Samuel chapter 8 is connected to this passage of Deuteronomy. So we have that established. So now, in that same chapter, verse 9. It says, God speaking to Samuel, Now therefore hearken unto their voice, howbeit yet protest solemnly unto them, and show them the manner of the king that shall reign over them. And Samuel told all the words of the Lord unto the people that asked of him a king. And he said, This will be the manner of the king that shall reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them for himself, for his chariots, and to be his horsemen. And some shall run before his chariots, and he will appoint him captains over thousands, and captains over fifties, and will set them to ear his ground, and to reap his harvest, and to make his instruments of war, and instruments of his chariots. And then it talks about a little bit later in like the next verse, one of the next verses, like, of giving tithes to the king. And so, and then it says in verse 18, And ye shall cry out in that day because of your king, which ye shall have chosen you, and the Lord will not hear you in that day. So basically, he's saying, you're going to regret giving yourself a king. These laws, you're going to regret these laws, because these laws make a king have a lot of control over you that you didn't have to deal with when it was just judges. Now that a king is going to be over you, he has much more power over the people. And so that makes sense why people would remove the Book of the Law, because it gave people didn't like the law. They were cry out in that day because of this law. So obviously it wasn't a law that everyone liked, so that there would be motivation to remove these laws. And where I read in this law for the king, the manner of the king, where Samuel said that the king shall have men appointed for himself as his warriors and as chiefs of thousands and fifties. That's verbatim. That's verbatim what the temple scroll says. And our copies of Deuteronomy's Book of the Law of the King do not have what Samuel says should be in that law. So that just to me is a strong confirmation that Samuel's law book was something similar or identical with the temple scroll as we have it. So there's so many more examples like that all throughout. Like one other example is Nehemiah. In Nehemiah, there's so many things in Nehemiah that correspond with the temple scroll and don't correspond with our copies of the law, but that, you know, one of them is the procedure for how to fight in war. It says in the temple scroll, when the war is very difficult and, you know, in major issue, half of the men of the army are supposed to be in your cities defending themselves, and the other half are to be out there in battle. And that's exactly the same thing that the temple scroll, Nehemiah, Book of Nehemiah, and the temple scroll says the same thing for that. And all the laws for the king, there's places you can find in the Old Testament where they're following these laws. So you have to ask the question, did someone, like, in order for someone to have faked this book, you know, to make this book out of nothing, what they had to do was take the entire Old Testament, look at it and go, okay, I'm going to take everything, put it all together masterfully, without flaw, and it's going to be like a perfect arrangement, like flowing, like everything is in great order, and that the scholars say that whoever wrote this temple scroll had to know a lot about how the priesthood worked, because his procedure for how he describes like the sacrifices and temple regulations, there's a lot of similarities to the oral law tradition of the Pharisees. When I say similarities, I mean there's concepts which are parallel. They have details which differ, but the general concepts have the same basic idea. I just find it very unlikely that some fake person, someone made up this, because it's so good. It seems much more likely that's, you know, like when someone does a hoax, like with hoaxes, there's a lot of hoaxes out in the world, and they're people try to write fake stuff all the time, fake books, fake writings, and sometimes people try to pass off scrolls as ancient when they're modern works. But usually in most of those cases, when there's a lot of evidence and you look into it, there's a lot of marks of it being a hoax. There's features which make it identifiable as likely to be a hoax. But you're not finding that in the temple scroll. You're not finding these features. It's like what you find when you're looking is you find those features in the Deuteronomy book that we have. You find the features of flawed version of something that's jumbled together like unintelligently. That's what our copies of Deuteronomy betray. They betray themselves as having poor editors, and whoever wrote it was not very wise in how they put it together. That's not the temple scroll. There's not a lot of really evidence against the temple scroll, and it's like a perfect document. I would say flawless in its basic content, and it's so much more compelling than all these other writings out there, I believe. So has anyone else seen the temple scroll in this light? I'm not sure. I came up with this theory on my own. Perhaps other people came up with it on their own and they haven't really published much about it yet. But as far as I know, I'm the only one who has presented this idea at such an intense level, because the idea is most believers are they don't like the concept of scripture being corrupt too much like that, because it throws off everything for them and it makes them doubt, you know, themselves and things like that. So the idea that the law that we have is condensed and missing so much scares people, and a lot of people wouldn't want to believe that. So it's like, it makes sense that most people haven't come to this conclusion on their own, because it's not something easy for someone to walk into themselves. It's much easier for someone who knows the truth to show it to others and lead them on the way. But I have a default acceptance of extra writings, extra documents, and at one time I accepted the Temple Scroll as a sixth book of law, a sixth book that Moses wrote. But then I saw something in the Gospel of Thomas which said that there are five trees in paradise which don't lose their leaves, and they last forever, or the fruit is forever or something. And I strongly believe that that's talking about the Torah, the five books of Moses, or the five trees, that their commandments are the leaves that they don't lose, and they give eternal life. And so I realized that according to the Gospel of Thomas, there's only five books of the law of Moses, not six. So I was like, wait a minute. So that must mean one of these six books is not, so it shouldn't be there. And if I had to choose between Deuteronomy and the Temple Scroll, it was a pretty easy choice. Okay, I'll go with the Temple Scroll, because Deuteronomy, like, it's weird, because when I was a Protestant and stuff, and then an earlier believer, when I was first coming to Torah, something seemed off about Deuteronomy. I didn't know what I didn't go out and like say this isn't scripture, but when you compare Deuteronomy to Exodus, Leviticus, and Numbers, Deuteronomy seems kind of unimportant. Like, it doesn't really give that much extra information that's not in one of the other books. It doesn't give too much, you know. I felt it was like all those speeches of Moses, for example, and things like that. It seemed more of like, I don't know, it doesn't seem as compelling to me. For some reason, I didn't find it. When I was studying the Torah, I usually didn't read Deuteronomy. That was probably the last book I went to, unless I was trying to find a certain passage. But otherwise, I wouldn't start from Deuteronomy and go to the end. And so when I started comparing Deuteronomy to the Temple Scroll and realizing, wait a minute, as I told you, it has a version of chapter 14, chapter 12, then it goes 13 exactly, 17 essentially exactly, 18, a little bit of 19, and then 20, 21, 22, like almost exactly, like, you know, those chapters. So I'm like, this can't be coincidence. It's going right along with Deuteronomy, like chapter after chapter after chapter. So it led me to conclude that the Temple Scroll must be the original version of the Book of Deuteronomy. So as far as I know, I'm the only one who's come to that conclusion independently. But I've been trying to teach this idea for the last about 4 years now. I believe the Temple Scroll was the original for about 4 years. So I've been trying to share that with people, and I find that a lot of people are open to it that are in the. It's strange, because you would think that a lot of people would not be open to it, but I find that there are a good number of people who are interested in seeing it, and usually the main ones who reject the Temple Scroll as the original are people who believe the Masoretic text is the most reliable, and people who believe in polygamy is okay. They're much more likely to reject it because of what it says about that one thing is enough for them to be, I don't know about that. And then those who believe in the oral law, who believe in the Talmud, they will very much likely, or the rabbis, the authority of the rabbis, they're much likely to not accept it. And, you know, Protestants who believe that the 66, or that God's word was perfectly preserved for us, they're the ones who are very least likely to believe this. But those who don't have the preconception and are open to the new evidence, and what do the ancient manuscripts say? And whatever they say, let's try to follow the best manuscripts that we can find. These are the people who are really, I find, open to, they're open to what I have to say, and the evidence I presented with people is, you know, pretty compelling, so that most people who go through this with me are convinced of it, except for those people that I mentioned. I plan on trying to keep spreading the word of it and publishing so there's just so much depth in this temple scroll thing. I mean, like, it's like changed everything for me. I wouldn't say necessarily changed everything for me, but it like has reformed my thinking. You know, it's like really opens my mind, and there's so much in here that people aren't getting. And I do believe the Dead Sea Scrolls are the most accurate scriptures that we have, with the vast majority of cases. And so I don't think it's a coincidence that the scrolls were found. I think that they were restored to us so that we could use them to restore the original faith of, to come to the original understanding of what was the true foundation of Judaism, what was the true foundation of Christianity. And then let's stop being hypocrites. Let's stop breaking the law, or let's stop, at the very least, let's stop teaching false stuff. And let's start seeking the truth in good scholarship. So for those who said they have to leave soon, this is probably a good place to leave. I will post the information online on Facebook after I conclude this with everyone. After the last person leaves, I will post all the files, or I will show everything. I will recommend versions to everybody. The translations that the scholars have done, the version that I did, and I'll give all that information. So for those who have to leave now, or they said they had to leave soon, this would be a good place to end it. And the rest of it will be recorded. Let's see here. Oh, okay. For those who are not on Facebook, I also have my email address. Let me type that email address for you guys in here. This is my email address. I have other email addresses, but that's the one I like to use the most. So you can contact me there, and what's blocked? Oh, a website. Okay. Okay. So yeah, just everyone who doesn't on Facebook, use that email. Oh wait, my email is blocked. Okay. Then does this work? It's basically it's what you see there, Onia777, and then it's @gmail.com. Okay, @gmail.com. And then there, I also have this one that you can write to me at. Every 1, 2, 3, 9. avy12309@yahoo.com. And so, yeah. Anyone else who wants to keep going, we can go a little bit further, a little bit deeper into this, so that there'll be more for the recording. But, you know, I'll let those who need to go leave now. So, let's see here. Let me try to see a couple other examples that I can give of the... Hold on one second. Yeah, so for instance, as I mentioned, the law of the war that Nehemiah corresponds with, I will, here's what Nehemiah says. It says in chapter 4, it says, "So it was from that time on that half of my servants worked at construction while the other half held the spears, the shields, the bows, and wore armor, and the leaders were behind all the house of Judah. Those who built on the wall and those who carried burdens loaded themselves so that with one hand they worked at construction and with the other held a weapon. Every one of the builders had his sword girded at his side as he built, and the one who sounded the trumpet was beside me." And then a little bit later it says, "So we labored in the work, and half of the men held the spears from daybreak until the stars appeared. At the same time, I also said to the people, let each man and his servant stay at night in Jerusalem, that they may be our guard by night and a working party by day. So neither I, my brethren, my servants, nor the men of the guard who followed me took off our clothes, except that everyone took them off for washing." But so, the temple scroll says, "If, however, the battle is going against him, they must send him half of the army, the men of war, but the other half of the army cannot be separated from their cities." So that, you know, that's a striking correspondence. And just giving the most interesting examples here. And then I'll write here in the what's the citation? First Chronicles 28:11-19. That right there. That's a very close correspondence with the temple scroll. And what does it say? It says that, it says in verse 19, "All this, said David, the Lord made me understand in writing by his hand upon me, even all the works of this pattern." So basically what David is saying is that Yahweh gave him a writing that had all these laws for the temple. And that writing doesn't exist anymore. It's lost. Whatever writing that was given to David, we don't have it. And yet, the temple scroll fits this writing that was given to David to the T, like, exactly. Everything in it that's being described is there in the temple scroll. So, it leads me to conclude that, you know, it says there was once a scroll that was given to David that had these laws, and it's like in the same order. The temple scroll like does the same basic order of these laws, so it's like, it makes me think that the scroll that David had was the temple scroll, or something very close to what we have as the temple scroll. So,
Anything else to say here? Let's see. I'm trying to skip some of the. I'm gonna do this one. This one's pretty interesting. It's a correspondence. Basically Jude, the book of Jude quotes from the book of Enoch, but it also quotes from an extra Moses book, the Testament of Moses, or the Assumption of Moses. And there are fragments of that book, and one of the fragments has a huge section that the rabbis preserved in their midrash for us, and there's a striking similarity. So here's one part of what the Temple Scroll says. So I'm going to read what the Temple Scroll says, it says in one section, this is a small little thing, and in the house upon which I shall make my name dwell, they shall be offered. And these are the burnt offerings day after day, according to the ruling of this regulation, continually from the sons of Israel, besides their freewill offerings. And all that they will offer, all their vows and all their presents, which they bring me for their acceptance, I shall accept them. They shall be for me a people, and I will be for them forever. And I shall dwell with them forever and always. I shall sanctify my temple with my glory, for I shall make my glory reside over it until the day of creation, when I shall create my temple, establishing it for myself for all days, according to the covenant which I made with Jacob at Bethel. For the files, people who are looking for the files, I can send everybody the information later. So if you have to go now, I'll send you guys the info later so you have it. So what I just read, from the Temple Scroll, matches strikingly with something that's in this extra writing that I found, where it says. So the words that I just read where he's going to create his temple according to the covenant which he made with Jacob at Bethel, it says, Moses thereupon said to the Messiah, God told me that Israel was to erect a temple to him upon earth, and I now see him build his own temple, and that too in heaven. The Messiah replied, Thy father Jacob saw the temple that will be erected on earth, and also the temple that God rears with his own hand in heaven. Like, that's like a super close correspondence. And this was written before the Temple Scroll was found. So this seems like a legitimate, like, fragment of a lost book. And that's confirming that the Temple Scroll is legitimate. Moses saw the Messiah in this other writing, and so. So I'll read a little bit more of that from this Midrash thing. So, that God rears with his own hand in heaven, and he clearly understood that it was the temple God constructed with his own hand in heaven as house of jewels, of pearls, and of the light of the divine presence that was to be preserved for Israel to all eternity, to the end of all generations. This was in the night when Jacob slept upon a stone, and in his dream beheld one Jerusalem upon earth, and another in heaven. God then said to Jacob, My son Jacob, today I stand above thee, as in the future thy children will stand before me. At the sight of these two Jerusalems, the earthly and the heavenly, Jacob said, The Jerusalem on earth is nothing. This is not the house that will be preserved for my children in all generations, but in truth, that other house of God that he builds with his own hands. But if thou sayest, continued the Messiah, that God with his own hands builds himself a temple in heaven, know then that with his hands also he will build a temple upon earth. When Moses heard these words from the mouth of the Messiah, he rejoiced greatly, and lifting up his face to God, he said, O Lord of the world, when will this temple built here in heaven come down to earth below? God replied, I have made known the time of the event to no creature, either to the earlier ones or to the later. How then should I tell thee? Moses said, Give me a sign so that out of the happenings in the world I may gather when that time will approach. And God said, I shall first scatter Israel as with a shovel over all the earth, so that they may be scattered among all nations in the four corners of the earth. And then shall I set my hand again the second time and gather them in that migrated. And those that, and so that ends there. And then when Moses had heard this, he departed from heaven with a joyous spirit. There's other stuff there that this other writing has, which is just very powerful, and it confirms to me the Temple Scroll. And there's one other thing I'll read, and I don't know how much more I will be presenting, but at least this I'll present. It's very cool. There's a fragment that was found not in the Temple Scroll, but in another fragment, which I believe was once part of the Temple Scroll. Can't 100% prove it, but I strongly believe, you know, based on the idea that the Temple Scroll was the original, then this fragment must have been part of the Temple Scroll originally. So here's what Jeremiah, it says in Jeremiah chapter 26. Now it came to pass when Jeremiah had made an end of speaking all that the Lord had commanded him to speak unto all the people, that the priests and the prophets and all the people took him, saying, Thou shalt surely die. Why hast thou prophesied in the name of the Lord, saying, This house shall be like Shiloh, and the city shall be desolate without an inhabitant? And all the people were gathered against Jeremiah in the house of the Lord. When the princes of Judah heard these things, then they came up from the king's house unto the house of the Lord, and sat down in the entry of the new gate of the Lord's house. Then spake the priests and the prophets unto the princes and to all the people, saying, This man is worthy to die, for he hath prophesied against this city, as ye have heard with your ears. Then spake Jeremiah unto all the princes and to all the people, saying, The Lord sent me to prophesy against this house and against this city all the words that you have heard. Therefore now amend your ways and your doings, and obey the voice of the Lord your God, and the Lord will repent him of the evil that he hath pronounced against you. As for me, behold, I am in your hand. Do with me as seemeth good and meet unto you. But know ye for certain that if ye put me to death, ye shall surely bring innocent blood upon yourselves and upon the city, and upon the inhabitants thereof. For of a truth the Lord hath sent me unto you to speak all these words in your ears. Then said the princes and all the people unto the priests and to the prophets, This man is not worthy to die, for he hath spoken to us in the name of the Lord our God. Then rose up certain of the elders of the land, and spake to all the assembly of the people, saying, Micah the Morishlite prophesied in the days of Hezekiah king of Judah, and spake to all the people of Judah, saying, Thus saith the Lord of hosts, Zion shall be plowed like a field, and Jerusalem shall become heaps, and the mountain of the house as the high places of a forest. Did Hezekiah king of Judah and all Judah put him at all to death? Did he not fear the Lord and besought the Lord, and the Lord repented him of the evil which he had pronounced against them? Thus might we procure great evil against our souls. And there was also a man that prophesied in the name of the Lord, Uriah, the son of Shemaiah of Kiriath-Jearim, who prophesied against this city and against this land according to all the words of Jeremiah. That's a little bit of a long passage. There's a shorter passage in this fragment, which I believe is from the Temple Scroll, and it was found on the Dead Sea Scrolls, and it says, And you shall keep all other commandments which your God commands you by the prophet's mouth, and you shall keep all these precepts, and shall return to Yahuwah your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and your God will repent of the fury of his great wrath in order to save you from your trials. However, the prophet who rises up to preach apostasy to you, to make you turn away from God, shall die. And if the tribe from which he comes should rise up and say, He is not to die, for he is a just man, he is a trustworthy prophet, You shall come with that tribe and your elders and your judges to the place which your God will choose in one of your tribes before the anointed priest, upon whose head the oil of anointing has been poured. And then it gets fragmentary there. But so this procedure that this fragment says corresponds exactly with what Jeremiah, with what they did in Jeremiah's day. So just like there's so much depth to this Dead Sea Scrolls, the Temple Scroll, and the, you know, this original law book that once existed, that I think if you start studying this on your own, you're going to be really amazed at, like, so much depth in this, you know, it, and let's see here. What's the question about, what I read corresponded with Jeremiah. Jeremiah, the procedure. It was chapter 26 of Jeremiah, and the procedure they did was to the exact correspondence to this fragment that I read. So it seems to me like the people of the Old Testament times had much more access to some of these other writings that we don't today anymore. I mean, you've got in 1st and 2nd Chronicles, it says, for the rest of the acts of such and such king, see the book of the prophet Samuel and the book of the prophecy of all these other prophets, you know, so there's a lot of material that once existed, which we no longer have. Just like the ancient libraries were destroyed of all these other writings in other languages, the same thing happened with the Hebrew language and the scriptures of the Hebrew language. A good majority of them were destroyed in libraries and stuff. So, Nehemiah quotes the Temple Scroll and gives a bunch of extra laws in which aren't found in our copies of the law, but which are found in the Temple Scroll. You know, I'll give just one more example from Nehemiah. It is the law of the wood offering. And it, Nehemiah says, for the wood offering, it says, Nehemiah chapter 10, we cast lots among the priests, the Levites, and the people, for bringing the wood offering into the house of our God according to our fathers' houses at the appointed times, or at the Moedim, year by year, to burn on the altar of the Lord our God, as it is written in the law. So what is Nehemiah saying? He said it is written in the law that the wood offering is to be brought into the temple of our God according to the fathers' houses. Am I still here, everybody? It blacked out for a second. According to the fathers' houses, and at appointed times year by year, so annually, and what do we have in the Temple Scroll? It says there's a festival of the wood offering. It's six days, and it each day, two of the tribes of the 12 tribes go on that day to bring the wood offering in a prescribed order. And this happens every year at this exact time. Always that. So it's a festival appointed times to bring the wood offering. Nehemiah says it was written in the law that this was so according to the fathers' houses, according to the tribes. It's not written in our copies of the law, but it is in the Temple Scroll. So that right there is one of the most compelling things that clinches it for me. But there's also the festival. The Temple Scroll speaks of a festival of the first fruits of new grain or new wheat. That's Shavuot. And then there's two other Shavuot periods that it gives. So a total of three Shavuot periods, one after the other. And the first one is the festival of the first fruits of new wheat. The second one, 50 days later, festival of the first fruits of new wine. And then a third one, 50 days later, festival of the first fruits of new oil. And then after that is the 6 days, directly following that is the 6 days of the wood offering. That's what the temple scroll says. And you find all throughout the Old Testament, it says, bring the tithes and first fruits. And then when it always says three things, and it says it in the same order always, pretty as far as I remember. It always says the wheat, the wine, and the oil. Only those three things, the first fruits of those three things. Is it a coincidence that it's giving you, bring the first fruits at the appointed times, and it gives those three first fruits, and it, you know, so that's, of course, Old Testament stuff corresponding with the idea that these festivals were once legitimate. They, you know, they were the time for the first fruits of each of these things, and Jubilees confirms it as well. And so there's just so much that I know, I'm convinced, and I hope you guys who have been listening to this and others who have been hearing about this information are convinced that what I'm saying is true, and that the temple scroll is in fact the original version. And then what you guys make of that, that's your choice to really figure out how to apply that, you know, if you're a believer, you know, following the law. And if you're not a believer, if you don't accept the authority of it, you still have a, this is very important information to understand history in the past and the Jewish and Christian heritage. And you can also refute Jews and Christians who think they know something when they don't really know as much as they think. So, let's see. I think I'm only going to say, I'm going to say two more things, and then, unless people insist on me doing it longer, because I don't want to keep you guys. So I'm just going to share two more things, and then you guys can tell me if there are some people who really want to stay longer, then we can do that, but otherwise we can end after these two small things. So in the portion that corresponds with Deuteronomy chapter 21 in the temple scroll, it reads, if a man passes on information against his people or betrays his people to a foreign nation or does evil against his people, you shall hang him on a tree and he will die. On the evidence of two witnesses or on the evidence of three witnesses, he shall be put to death and they shall hang him on the tree. If it happens that a man has committed a capital offense and he escapes amongst the nations and curses his people and the children of Israel, he also you shall hang on a tree and he will die. And their bodies shall not remain all night upon the tree, but thou shalt in any wise bury him that day. For he that is hanged is accursed by God and man, that thy land be not defiled, which I give thee for inheritance. That's an interesting point. Yeah, Judas hanged himself for treason. But so, when you look at this passage in Deuteronomy, it's ridiculous. Like, it's ambiguous and doesn't help any, like, it doesn't really give you any understanding of, like, when are we to hang people. It doesn't tell you, where is it, hold on, I have it set aside so I can show you, Yeah, so Deuteronomy chapter 21 and verse 21 reads, it reads verse 22, and if a man have committed a sin worthy of death, and he be to be put to death, and thou hang him on a tree, his body shall not remain all night upon the tree, but thou shalt in any wise bury him that day, for he that is hanged is accursed by God. And that thy land be not defiled, which the Lord thy God give thee for an inheritance. Deuteronomy 21:22-23. So, what you can see is there's clear marks of, like, abbreviation, where the temple scroll doesn't have that. It gives the laws of, this is how you are to deal, this is when you are to hang people. But all our copies of Deuteronomy say is, when you decide to hang someone, make sure you don't leave them on that tree. Like, it doesn't really make sense to say that. You know, like, it's just kind of random. So the temple scriptures has so much more depth and validity, and it really reads more like an inspired writing than our copies of Deuteronomy. And the other thing that I wanted to read was basically Deuteronomy chapter 22. I'm not going to read it, but what I'm going to tell you is throughout that, most of it is like laws for marriage or sexuality. Like it's like a betrothal issues. Yeah, Messiah was hanged on a tree, but his accusation was blasphemy. Yes, but what it said, it wasn't just being a traitor. It was, what did it say? It was, betrays his people to a foreign nation or does evil against his people. So basically, betraying his people doesn't necessarily have to mean like, you know, a traitor to, in another sense of, it can mean like morally being a traitor. You know, you're apostatizing in a way that you're leading astray the people in a major way. So when you look through Deuteronomy chapter 22, it gives laws of like of the betrothal. But then it let me see. I don't have it offhand at the moment, but basically, it's actually right here. I have it actually. So it says, after going, then the man that lay with her shall give unto the damsel's father 50 shekels of silver, and she shall be his wife, because he hath humbled her. He may not put her away all his days. End of topic. That's where the topic ends, and now a new topic is being introduced in Deuteronomy, our copies of Deuteronomy. And the verse reads, a man shall not take his father's wife, nor discover his father's skirt. Yeah, so that was the new topic. Then, the very next verse abandons the topic it just introduced, and goes on to another irrelevant topic, where it says, he that is wounded in the stones, or hath his privy member cut off, shall not enter into the congregation of the Lord. And then it goes on and starts saying, all the people who can't be in the congregation of the Lord. So wait a minute, it's like, you just went to a new topic, and then you just abandoned the new topic you introduced. But in the temple scroll, where we see that, it says this, a man shall not take his father's wife, nor discover his father's skirt. But it continues and says, a man shall not take his brother's wife, nor discover his brother's skirt, the son of his father or the son of his mother, because it is sexual impurity. A man is not to take his sister, the daughter of his father or the daughter of his mother. It is an abomination. A man is not to take the sister of his father or the sister of his mother, because it is depravity. A man is not to take the daughter of his brother or the daughter of his sister, because it is abomination. And then it breaks off there. But so you could see, in the temple scroll, it wasn't just a new topic. One verse, oh, and now it's another topic, irrelevant, sorry, we're moving on. It didn't do that. The temple scroll introduces a new topic and then sticks with that topic and goes through it fully in depth, and then once it finishes, then it goes on to the next topic. So all throughout the temple scroll, you'll find this when you compare Deuteronomy. If you compare it, you'll see in many places our copies of Deuteronomy have a topic, and then move on to a new topic for like a verse or two, and then move on to a new topic that's completely unrelated, and it's like, wait, you didn't finish what you're trying to tell us here. You're just kind of jumping around erratically. And why is it like that? Well, as I said, because when they removed the portions relating to the temple and the priesthood and stuff like that, or passages which disagreed with them, everything was in a mess in because they were broken sentences. So they had to rearrange it to make it to fix it. And where they put certain passages, they rearranged certain passages, but when they were rearranging passages, like, for instance, Deuteronomy chapter 13. In some versions, it starts with verse 1 of chapter 13, but in other versions, it starts with the final verse of chapter 12. So the question is, does it begin with does chapter 13 begin with the final verse of chapter 12 or the first verse of chapter 13? It's like, where is the line where it's a new topic? So sometimes they didn't know. So when they were rearranging the passages, they would rearrange stuff, but evidence of their poor editing is preserved in their rearrangement. Because when they rearranged it, they didn't realize that what they were rearranging was part of another context or another topic. So that when they put it somewhere else, they created a text that is random and jumbled together. And you can see the evidence of that in the text as we have it in Deuteronomy. You can see it all over the place. It's messy. It jumps around. It's erratic. But the temple scroll, if God makes scripture and if he speaks to people, prophecy and divine inspiration, the temple scroll is something you would expect from something like a perfect being that is guiding the process and saying, okay, it's an ordered, flowing, thematic, it all's together, it's consistent, one topic covered to the next, etc. So the Book of Deuteronomy, if it was submitted as a thesis for a college paper or something, you know it would probably not get the best grade. It would probably get more like a C or something, or maybe a D for Deuteronomy. But it would, but the temple scroll on the other hand, I think would get like a near perfect grade, if not a perfect grade, 100%, because it's so perfect. I don't think anyone could make something like that just by themselves, because it's so, like, you have to read through it, and you'll see, like, wow, this is, if they took Deuteronomy and made it like this, and then took all the other stuff from all over, like Jubilees, one book of the Old Testament, another book, and all together, and then they, like, massively put it together, like, they have to be pretty, whoever did that is, like, really high IQ and very intelligent. I mean, it just, like, everything we see, it just makes much more sense to conclude the temple scroll is the original version. You can always sweep new evidence under the rug and twist things to say, to defend your current, your former view. But when more and more evidence comes that makes your view unlikely, more and more unlikely, then it makes more sense to go with the origin, the more likely, what's the most likely explanation? And that's one of the principles that logicians try to use, where you can come up with all these different theories, like I'll just give one example. Am I a regular human to you guys right now? Or am I an alien from another planet who has been put here to test you guys? Or am I a computer program, that's trying to deceive you guys into believing something evil or something? You could come up with all these conspiracies and all these alternate explanations. And technically, I guess it is technically possible that I'm a hologram and that I'm a alien and, all these other ideas you could come up with. But the evidence is overwhelmingly in favor that I'm a human and that I am sincere in what I'm saying. I'm not crazy or anything. And the same thing with the temple scroll. You could come up with all kinds of other alternate explanations that defend our copies of Deuteronomy as the original. But it just makes much more sense and more likely to be the case that that the temple scroll is the original. So that's the main presentation, and a little bit of study for you there. But as I said, I could keep going for those if some of you guys really, really want to stay for the rest, for some more, I can, but otherwise we'll end it. So if you guys can tell me in the comments, if you are ready to end now, or, who wants to stay any longer, or if you have any final questions. Are there any final questions before you guys leave? Now's the time to write that. Okay, it looks like we've got all right, and so again, you know, looks like we'll probably stop it here. Unless, you know, I get like in the next 10 seconds someone saying more, you know, or something like that. But otherwise, okay, and yeah, as I said, questions. So if you have final questions before you go, I can answer those. So that, I guess we'll end it with that. Ask you guys questions of what I've said or anything else that you need to know before we end it. How does this finding affect our understanding of Messiah and the New Testament? Thank you very much for your compliments and kind remarks, everyone. And basically, you said two. Berean asked, but he said two questions, but I only see one question. So is there another one you have too? This question that you asked is, how does the temple scroll affect our understanding of Messiah and the New Testament? Well, one of the things is people say that new commandments cannot be added to the law. That's what some people claim. I actually don't believe that. I think that the Deuteronomy, for instance, says that when a prophet like Moses will come, you know, Moses was a lawgiver, a prophet like Moses, he will give new understanding and new laws, new commands that we have to follow. And so Deuteronomy actually, as we have it, endorses the Messiah adding new things. But the temple scroll even more endorses the idea that, you know how it says, do not add or take away from the word that I speak to you today. Well, here's the funny thing. In Exodus, Leviticus, and Numbers, you don't see Yahuwah say, do not add or take away from the laws that I'm giving you in this book. Don't do it. And yet you see it in Deuteronomy. So maybe he put it in Deuteronomy, don't do that, because he knew that they might be inclined to do it for Deuteronomy. And they wouldn't be so much inclined to do it for the other books, but for Deuteronomy, there was something about the original version, the temple scroll, there was something about it where Yahuwah knew they would be tempted to remove things or even add things to it, which they did both of those things. And so he said, don't do that. Don't remove or don't take away and don't add to the words that I'm telling you today. I don't interpret that as saying don't add new commandments. No one can add new commandments. God cannot make new requirements for us. I interpret that as saying don't alter the Torah. Follow what the Torah says. Preserve it correctly. And don't add words to it. Don't add commandments to it. Don't take away commandments from it. Just leave what I've said for you to obey. Obey my commandments. Obey my Torah. Don't corrupt my Torah and destroy my Torah by, like, you know, making the Book of Deuteronomy. Don't do that. You know. So basically, the New Testament, I think, has the idea of new commandments and extra commandments, and the Temple Scroll is very strongly the idea of extra commandments. So it will make you more likely or more open to the idea that maybe there are extra commandments in the New Testament too that we have lost and we need to follow as well. And for the Messiah, the Temple Scroll doesn't go into that as much detail about the Messiah, but as I said, there's broken fragments and the beginning and ending are missing, but the connection that the Temple Scroll has with the Apocrypha book that I read a little bit earlier ago from the Testament fragment from the Midrash, that is strongly about Messiah. That affects our understanding of Messiah and really confirms the Temple Scroll. And Jude, as I said, confirms that extra Apocrypha book of Moses. So when the Messiah says in the New Testament, if you had believed, like something to the effect of, you would have believed me if you had believed Moses, because Moses wrote about me. but yet you do not, you're not willing to believe Moses, so how can you believe me? And so basically, the way he says that, I'm not doing justice to what Messiah said. I can't remember exactly how he said it, but the way the Messiah says that makes me think that he was referring to certain extra apocrypha writings which he saw the Moses wrote of the Messiah in this testament, an assumption of Abraham. He wrote his he saw the Messiah, he spoke to the Messiah. You know, and as he said, Abraham saw my day and was glad. That's from other writing too, extra writing. So we see that Messiah had that extra, so that the words of the New Testament seem to confirm that they were extra Moses writings. And the Book of Jubilees also is closely corresponding with the Temple Scroll in a way that if you accept the Book of Jubilees, then you pretty much have to accept the Temple Scroll because it's so interrelated. Like the Jubilees says these laws are to be written in the Book of the Law, and these laws aren't written in our copies, but they are written in the Temple Scroll. So, you know, Jubilees confirms and connects necessarily with the Temple Scroll. And I'm going to answer the question of the author of the Temple Scroll. The author of the Temple Scroll, in my belief, it was Moses who wrote it down. The reason for that is Yahuwah present when he's speaking, he says, "Your brother Aaron." Like he addresses someone. He doesn't mention their name, but he says, "Your brother Aaron," which makes it seem like he's talking about, you know, Moses' brother. And that would suggest that it was Moses that he was speaking to. And so at the very least, you know, if people don't accept the Temple Scroll, or, you know, people who don't accept the Bible as divinely inspired or, you know, written by who it was, I believe that the original version of Deuteronomy was the Temple Scroll. Whoever wrote it, it was the original version. And I believe that the person who wrote it was saying and claiming to be Moses himself. So he was presenting himself as Moses. Whether or not it truly was Moses, that's a matter of faith. If you believe in the divine inspiration of the book, and if you believe, if you have faith that these writings were actually written by who they say they were written by, then, you know, that would be who wrote it. I would say if Moses ever existed, and if he ever wrote a document, like a book of the law, I think the Temple Scroll is something that fits very strikingly with what you would expect from something. Like, it's very, like, you wouldn't expect Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy doesn't seem like something Moses would write. There's too many things about it that are, you know, doesn't make sense. But with the Temple Scroll, on the other hand, it's very much compelling, and there's so much in there that connects with all these other writings. The Dead Sea Scrolls, like, there's some ancient stuff in there that's just really more impressive than what we have. And there's a final thing I want to say related to this idea of an extra, you know, extra Deuteronomy. There's also an original version of Genesis, not the original version of the book of Genesis, but the sources of Genesis that Moses used. There was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls something called the Genesis Apocryphon, and it contains in it a book of Lamech, a book of Noah, and a book of Abraham. And it's the word, you know, they speak in the first person, and when you read it, it just seems like so much more inspiring and authoritative and authentic than what we have in Genesis, so that I believe these are really old and ancient writings, and they have the spirit, like, they have an Old Testament spirit, they have a very high quality that really sounds like it's an ancient writing. It doesn't sound like these later Apocrypha books that are kind of, you know, the later Apocrypha books sometimes have features in it which, like, maybe that was written by a Christian, or maybe that doesn't sound like something an Old Testament prophet would say. That seems a little weird how they're wording that. But the Dead Sea Scrolls, all these books, these, like, extra books, it words it in a way that's, like, really believable and really, like, in spirit of what the ancient writings. So, you know, if we have no reason to believe, there's no good reason to trust or to believe that Genesis and Deuteronomy as we have it are more authentic, more ancient, more reliable than the Temple Scroll and the Genesis Apocryphon. There's no reason. It's just a matter of faith for those people. But I think that if you're going to go on faith and reason, faith and evidence, the evidence points that if there was a divinely inspired of these writings, Temple Scroll and Genesis Apocryphon are definitely more ancient than our copy of Deuteronomy and Genesis. There's just, I don't think you can really deny it if you're honest with yourself. And so you should do that study sometime of the Genesis Apocryphon, because that's another mind-blowing thing of the original, you know, the sources of Genesis. And there's some really amazing stuff there. And it's also, it connects with Jubilees, it connects with Genesis, it connects with, like, all these different writings. Like, there's some legitimate and really compelling scrolls in the Dead Sea Scrolls. So, I mean, that's pretty much it to say. There was the other question of the tribes of the law of the king. The king will take 1,000 from each tribe, a total of 12,000. But in Revelation 7, there's 12,000 of every tribe for a total of 144,000. Well, the thing with that, I think that's just in that instance, in Revelation, it's not warriors. They're not people who are his part of his army, but they're people who are I don't know how to put it, but they're just they're holy, set apart, but they're not part of the army that the law of the king is saying. So I would and the 12 priests and 12 Levites and 12 princes are 36, but corresponding to the 24 elders of Revelation, like, I'm not sure who the 24 elders in Revelation are. Revelation never says who they are, so I think it can be debated who they are. I think that the laws for Temple Scroll are still pretty much all valid, and that they should still be done, and that they will be done and instituted when the Messiah returns. And the quotation of Jude, of quoting Enoch, coming with 10,000s of his saints, I think that's just a way of, like you know, in language, like, it starts, like, with one, then it goes tens, so ones, tens, hundreds, thousands, tens, thousands, hundred thousands, you know, million, and then it goes like that, right? So when Enoch just says 10,000s of his saints, I think it's just, like, going along those lines of, it's not trying to say only 10,000. So, yeah, myriad and 10,000 are closely related words in the language. There was one other thing someone asked that I wanted to answer, and that was pretty much it. What was it? Let me just scroll up. Okay, and the final thing was, when does the tribulation begin? And, you know, you can be debating on when that will happen. I'm strongly of the conviction that when the Messiah is going to return, it's not going to be anytime soon, in a sense of, it probably won't happen in any of our lifetimes. It might happen in our lifetimes if we live to be almost 200 years old. But otherwise, I don't think it's going to happen for us. So many people are going to say, oh, he's going to come back in my lifetime. You know, everyone's so focused on, they want to believe that he's going to come back. But the fact is, he hasn't. Every single time that they predict his coming, it fails. He doesn't come. And, you know, it happens every time. And they make these predictions every few years, and without fail, they always are wrong. So it's a pretty safe bet that whenever you hear someone say he's coming back pretty soon, then it's not true. The difference with my prediction is, I'm trying to tell you when I believe the scriptures teach it's going to happen. I'm not trying to make it happen in my lifetime. That's what everyone else is trying to do. They're trying to say, it's going to happen really soon. I know. I got it. They want to be part of the kingdom. They want it so bad. So they believe it so bad until they force it to fit what they want to be true. But I try not to do that. You know, maybe sometimes I don't do that 100% perfectly, but I try my best to not believe like that, and instead I'm trying to figure out what do the scriptures really say when it's going to happen. And in my understanding, what the scriptures say is when it's going to happen, it's in about 160 years from now when he's going to return. 160 years. So I try to tell people, no, I don't believe it's going to happen in my lifetime, unless I live, again, unless I live pretty old. And I have no interest in trying to, like, you know, make false predictions or, you know, I want as much time as we can because there's so much work to be done. I don't even know if we can do it in that such short amount of time. So, you know, we don't have much time left. So there's a lot to do. If the scriptures are true and going to be fulfilled, there's a lot that has to be done that hasn't been done yet. And there's a lot of extra books that talk about final prophecies, which are to happen before he returns. And if all of these are true, there's like so much that has to be done that hasn't been done yet. Like, you know, it's crazy. So I really think if you guys think it's bad right now, like how bad the world is, you have no idea what it's going to be like. It's going to be way worse than you could possibly imagine. But what I do know is that the scriptures do say there's going to be times of fake peace, or, you know, there's going to be like in and out. There's going to be times of temporary peace. Okay, it's going to seem like everything's over. All right, the worst of it was over. And then some years later, then there's going to be more crazy stuff happening. And then there's going to be peace again. It's like, okay, things, I think that was the worst of it. That was the last of it. Sort of like a pregnant woman in labor, you know, like, oh man, that was another one. Ah, I think it's over now. All right. But now it comes back again, you know, and it keeps coming until eventually, finally, after like 24 hours of labor, you know, hopefully, I don't wish that upon anyone, but 24 hours of labor finally gives birth. So, you know, that's what kind of like I view it. Like, we're going through a long labor pains, and we're only beginning. It's the beginning of labor pains. Didn't it say that? Didn't the Messiah say that in the New Testament? That's the beginning of pains or something like that. So anyways, don't look for the tribulation anytime soon. There's always going to be tribulation in every age. There's persecution every age. There's people killing each other, murdering each other, hatred, warmongering, racism, sexism, you know, all that stuff. People clashing, the religion, Islam, extremist religions from all over the place. So, you know, there's always going to be stuff happening. And as the New Testament says, there will be wars and rumors of wars. But that's the beginning of things. It's going to get much worse than that. So anyways, thank you all for attending. I hope you enjoyed it all. This is going to be in recording. So if you really liked it and want to listen to it again, you can listen to the recording I'll be posting on Facebook. And on an email, if you email me and you don't have Facebook, just email me and I'll give you the audio. Thank you and shalom to you all. I'll send you guys the PDF files on Facebook. Thank you all for attending, and I appreciate your compliments and that you guys enjoyed it.